Holy crap.
People persist in doubting the evidence.
Don't run and hide. Don't be afraid. Don't turn away any longer. The truth will set you free.
You're listening to Jimmy Church Fade to Black on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
Listen to all of our partners towards Jimmy Church on Dark Matter Radio.
And now, your host, the captain of conspiracy, the prince of paranormal. This ain't your daddy's radio network show. This is Jimmy Church, Fade to Black.
What is that? I don't even know why I'm posting this, but you did anyway, status. I see that. All right, let me click some more buttons here. Yeah, let's be more professional, church. All right, Dale's in the house. How you doing, everybody? Let's go. Day three, Halloween week. Fade to Black, bespoke radio for the masses. Yeah, you heard the Starbucks. I did too. I took a swig. Today's Wednesday, October 29th, 299 days into the new year. MC, that'll get a retweet every time right there. Watch, bam. How you doing? Let's go. Let's go. Fired up. Fired up every night, aren't we? Live from the JP Motorsports Studios right here in downtown Burbank, California. For KJCR and the Dark Matter Radio Network, I am your oh-so-humble host, Jimmy Church. How you doing? Yeah. Man, we got a good one tonight. How do you top last night? Man, oh man, oh man. Chad Lewis in a haunted graveyard. Anybody remember that monster growl last night? Was that too much? Adam Gorightly sent me the file, which I think I accidentally played it last night. And I think that deserves, I just did that for you, Space Boy, spaceboymusic.com. That deserves its own YouTube video, that little segment. I got freaked out. All right, let's go. Let's get this one cracking. Everybody here, eviler, evilest, evil. I like that. Halloween week name changes. Big salute to the proud men and women in uniform. Without them, there is no me, there is no you, there is no us. Defending that Constitution of ours. That's right. I wouldn't be on this microphone. Well, I might, but I'd be speaking another language, doing some government propaganda. That's what I'd be doing. Oh, I love my Starbucks. Faders.org. I was over there earlier. I'm gonna do this really quick. I have to. Faders.org is freaking me out. I mean, I don't think it gets better than this. I used to, back in the day, what I would do is I would go to UFOmind.com. I would go there, Paracast, you know, I'd jump Paranet, jump around, and Coast to Coast, of course, RPL.com. And you know, I had my little routine that I would do every single day. And now I'm one-stop shopping it, man. I'm going to faders.org. I got to tell you, this is quite possibly the coolest. This is the reason to have the internet right here. Well, that in this show. But this website has really turned into something else. This is just absolutely amazing. For everybody listening right now, if you haven't been there, faders.org. www.faders.org. You've got to go and check it out. It's just the coolest thing ever. Bar none. And there's good stuff out there. Nothing compares. All right. Podcast got all updated. Let's get all the main stuff out of the way. Got the podcast updated again today. I guess there was a little technical snafu somewhere. It's been resolved. Everything's cool. Still haven't quite figured out the smoothest way to get the podcast done and figure out, you know, I don't have a podcast guy that just does it. You know, it's something that gets done. All right. Today, let's get this cracking. I am fired up. We have got just an amazing show lined up today. And if you smart, if you, before I start to crank things off, Baphomet, crazy subject, Baphomet. And if you know anything, checked him out, whatever it is. Tonight's going to be your show with Tracy. And it's a crazy, crazy story. So out there, all you fade or nots, Baphomet, you got any pics, anything that you like? I want to see those on Twitter tonight. When Tracy joins us, she'll be with us at the top of the hour. Baphomet's a crazy, crazy thing. And her association with Baphomet and Cain and the Ouija board, I'm going to save all of that for her. But it is an amazing story and book that she has out right now, Clock Shavings. We'll talk about all of that tonight, but I am fired up. And then, of course, we have the real deal. Father Ashcraft will be with us at the bottom of the hour. And the real deal, and I'm going to save that too as well, but exorcism and Ouija and Baphomet and Cain all in one night on Halloween is the way to go. I'm telling you right now, get comfortable. If there is any way to top the show from last night, any way to top Linda Godfrey from Monday is tonight. I'm going to give it my best shot. It's going to be insane. Last night, Chad Lewis, I'll get to that in a second too as well. But that was some radio stuff last night. That was just absolutely tremendous. All right. So with that, that's a brief setup for tonight. Let's get this one cracking. Is everybody ready? Ancient Aliens, the series. I can't comment on that for a couple of weeks. Oh, what did I just say? Did I just say something? All right. Today, Richard Dreyfuss, 67 years old. So, with that, and I know this is kind of strange, but we're going to do this right now. Jaws and Close Encounters. I think for everybody, movie critics, fans, everybody's top 10 list of greatest films of all time, those two movies are on that list. Richard Dreyfuss starred in both. Talking about punching your lottery ticket, right? Did it practically back to back. Now, that's the Twitter question for tonight. Oh, check that out. Hey, Ken. Ken, what you just tweeted right there, that is good stuff. Did you copy Doug on this? This is a great video. Doug Aldridge, Dio, Gates of Babylon, live in London, 2005. Yeah, that's a pretty good cut right there. I just retweeted. You should tweet that to Doug. see what he's doing. Anyway, Jaws or Close Encounters? Which one is the better movie? You got top 10. You got a top 10 list. These two are going on it. Which one is number 6? Which one is number 5? That is a good question, and I cannot wait. I have no idea. Does that mean that Jimmy's on the Ancient Alien show? Maybe. Not yet. I don't know. Could be. Close Encounters. Robert Noel comes in with that. I want to know. Jaws or Close Encounters? That's a tough one. Because when either movie comes on, I have them both on DVD and I watch them all the time. As a matter of fact, Jaws, the anniversary edition, you know, it's got like 3 DVDs in there. It's got a full DVD of outtakes. Jaws, man. Jaws is that good. Jaws is brilliant. It's Godfather brilliant. But then so is Close Encounters. Close Encounters is right there. It's a brilliant, brilliant, brilliant movie. You can't make a better movie than those two. You got to make a Godfather. You got to make a 2001 A Space Odyssey to top that. You got to make a Shining to top that. That's how great those two movies are. And Dreyfus was in both. So where do you go? I want to know. That is a question for everyone. Which one is the better movie? I'm watching. And you know what? Okay, I see Jaws. Close Encounters. Yeah, I'd say we're running 50-50 right now. And that's totally fair. I wanted to maybe be surprised that maybe it would all be Jaws or Close Encounters. Because it can go either way. Don't let me down. Fate or Fear Week. right. Jaws or Close Encounters? Jaws or Close Encounters? Okay, follow us on Twitter right now. You wonder what I'm talking about. Follow us on Twitter, at JChurchRadio, hashtag DMRadioNet. See a lot of new names here tonight, by the way. Right to my left in the studio, I have a monitor that is just Twitter, TweetDeck. I've got 3 columns that shoot across. I have my normal column, I have DMRadioNet, and I have F2BQ, which is the questions column. And they just click by all night. Click, 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 click. The conversations, the sub stuff, the inside, the outside. It is crazy what goes on Twitter. And I do it all night long. And I read your tweets. I follow. You got questions. You got comments. I follow. It's totally interactive. You know, we are the 21st century here at Fade to Black on the Dark Matter Radio Network. Follow us on Twitter. Follow us on Facebook. Subscribe on YouTube. Everything is Fade to Black at J Church Radio. Simple. I respond. I do. I hang out. I do the Facebook thing. I do Twitter. I do it. I write back. I comment. You got anything to say? Say it. It's all done for you. And that is what bespoke radio means. Tonight, Father Ashcraft at the bottom of the hour. Exorcism. Oh, yeah. He's going to tell us all about his latest case. I'll ask him again tonight on the air. Is it a case? Is it a client? Is it a patient? How do you classify that inside the church? How do you do that? Wait till you hear his answer. Pretty interesting. And then at the top of the hour, Tracy Twyman, Clock Shavings. And, you know, that's an interesting title for a book, isn't it? Clock Shavings. Have you ever heard the term clock shavings? I haven't. I want to know what, I don't even know what that means. Clock shavings. And then tomorrow night, that's right, Shah, Fader Night, readings, your readings. All night. Shoot me an email to Jimmy at JimmyChurchRadio.com. This is Fade to Black, bespoke radio for the masses. We are only on the Dark Matter Radio Network. Keith, are you going to get us on Armed Forces Radio? What's up with that? AFN? Armed Forces Network. I'll be back right after this. Stay with us.
You're listening to Jimmy Church Fade to Black on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
Ladies and gentlemen, girls and boys, you have tuned into the latest phenomenon in late night talk radio, Fade to Black, starring the inimitable Jimmy Church, showcasing his continuing quest in pursuit of knowledge of the strange and paranormal. Sit back, open your mind, and let's get cracking.
What's up, revolutionaries? It's me, Jimmy Church. Do you have an IRS or state tax issue? Well, I did, and I called national tax experts. My problems were fixed, done, fini, and man, I gotta tell you, it was a relief. National tax experts are a recognized tax office that services clients in all 50 states. Doesn't matter where you live. Give them a call. I'm telling you, they take the time to understand each and every client's individual financial status as well as their financial goals. And that's exactly what you need, my brother, when you're taking on the evil three-letter. So, seriously, give them a call today at 1-877-909-5444. Again, 1-877-909-5444. Or go check out their website, www.nattaxexperts.com. That's NATTAXEXPERTS.com. Tell them Jimmy sent you.
This is KJCR at JimmyChurchRadio.com.
On the Dark Matter Radio Network.
Oh, yeah. Fade to Black, bespoke radio for the masses. Who's got Tracy's Twitter handle? I just saw it blasted by. Get Tracy on here. Tracy R. Twyman. I just saw her picture. Come on, Fader Knots. Don't let me down. Get it up. Get it up. Say hi to Tracy. Get her in here. I know she's listening. She's in the batter's box. All right. All right. All right. Chad Lewis sent me an email today. This is what he said. He said, I did survive the cemetery. That's from Chad. I wonder if he got pics. I was just glad that he made it out alive. That was pretty crazy. And this email came in from Ben Miller. He says, I don't ever remember hearing a live radio show from a graveyard at night. This may have been a historic first. Monday and Tuesday's shows, very entertaining. That is what good radio should be. Ghoulishly yours, Ben Miller. Yeah, you might be right on that, actually. You might be right. It just reminds me of WKRP in Cincinnati. The turkeys out of the helicopter. That's what that was last night. So much fun. You just never know, do you? You don't. You don't know how it's going to break down. Oh, man. Hey, has anybody seen Lynn tonight? Lynn Lewis? Is she in the house? Because I'm sipping off her mug. The Denver Broncos fan, police now say, the fan that went missing for 5 days simply went for a walk. Huh? You know what? I'm relieved. I think it's now going to turn into something personal and family related. You know, he wasn't arrested. They I don't know what they would have arrested him for, but gave him a place to sleep until his family got there. Paul Kitterman, 53, was found safe Tuesday night in Pueblo, Colorado, 110 miles south of Denver's Sports Authority Field at Mile High. asked why he vanished, he told an officer that he had his fill of football and decided to go for a walk, end quote. He wanted to walk somewhere warmer. Now, going from Denver to somewhere warmer and you're walking, do go into the bar next door to the field. You don't need to walk to Pueblo. Kitterman further told police he ditched his Broncos hat so no one would recognize him. And he mentioned, and I'm quoting here, sleeping in treed areas and in bushes during his journey to Pueblo. I think there is something more to this, but now that he's safe, it is none of our business, is it? Does he have to pay for the search party? You know, the police almost didn't touch this. If the media hadn't jumped in on this, I don't know. You know, because he's an adult, he can do what he wanted. He didn't do anything illegal. He walked away. Nothing illegal about that. Didn't abandon anybody. Well, you know, I think even him and his son, they rode there together. He didn't have the responsibility of driving back. He's got no cell phone, got no credit cards, got $50 on him. Ditches his Broncos hat and split. Guess he's not a Peyton Manning fan. But just decided to take a walk. Crazy. But it's okay, I guess. Crazy story. There's something more to it, but it's a family matter now. That's all private. But he is alive, and that's all that matters. He is safe. And there you go. The 2,000-degree river of lava could swallow a dozen Hawaiian homes in the next couple of days, and there's nothing anybody can do about it. I've been watching the video, and that is as destructive as anything that you can imagine. It's just coming, burning, engulfing, anything in it. There's nothing. It leaves nothing behind. It's crazy. Now that it's right out of any Hollywood movie, and we're watching it go down. It's pretty fascinating. It's a drag. At least it's moving slow. You got enough time to hang out and watch and get all the good stuff out of your house. And I suppose you have, if you live in Hawaii and you own a house, you've got volcano insurance, right? Right? Got earthquake insurance here in Southern California. I'm assuming you've got some kind of natural disaster. I don't know. You know, but that's what you do. Get the pictures. Grab the family safe. A couple of computers. The other stuff you hold near and dear, like your 59 Stratocaster. And you might even grab the Marshall head and blow out of there. But wow, crazy. The flow advanced 275 feet overnight. That's a football field. 270 feet, said Daryl Oliveira, director of the Hawaii County Civil Defense. It speeds up and slows down, but on average, it's moving at a rate of about 15 to 30 feet per hour. Absolutely insane. North Korean leader Kim Jong-un, who recently disappeared from public view for about 6 weeks, apparently had a cyst removed from his right ankle. South Korea's National Intelligence Service told lawmakers during a closed-door meeting that a cyst was found on Kim's right ankle earlier this year between May and June. The cyst may have caused muscle or nerve damage and prompted him to have ankle surgery between September and October. And there you go. Now, I've got to say, if you're a head of state, how does something like that just get discussed? Don't you go to the doctor all the time? Don't you have a doctor like checking you out every single day? Don't you have a guy walking behind you? Don't you have a? I mean, this isn't the United States. With Obamacare, that's a whole nother situation. You're a head of state. don't you have a doctor? Just like you sneeze and they check you out. How did they just discover a cyst that is causing nerve damage? And you saw how the guy was limping in film, video. How does that happen? If I'm a head of state, my body is correct. I'm telling you right now. I go see the doctor every day. What are you doing here? Just getting checked up, doc. That's what I'm doing here. Why? Because I'm the head of state. That's why. And I can. How do they, you know, how does it, how does something like that just grow to the, it's crazy. Of all the countries too, you know, it's him. Unbelievable. The public is now, check this out. This is hilarious. The public is now being warned to forget about grabbing rocket debris on the East Coast as souvenirs. And I'm quoting here. It had a lot of hazard, talking about the Antares rocket. It had a lot of hazardous materials on board that people should not be looking for or wanting to collect souvenirs over, says Frank Culbertson, a former NASA astronaut and now a manager at Orbital Sciences Corporation. He goes on to say, if you find anything that washes ashore in your local area or came down on your farm or in your yard, definitely do not touch it and keep people away from it. He goes on, hey, hold on, let me just stop right there. What could possibly be on a piece of rocket that would be considered hazardous? You know, aluminum, titanium, whatever it's made out of, I don't know. No, there's something else that they don't want us. They just don't want us to know. There's something going on. I'm telling you right now, there was something on that rocket that we're not supposed to know about. So what do they tell you? Space herpes. What do they tell you? That's not me. I'm just reading Twitter. They tell you something like that to freak you out. No, Johnny, don't touch it. Don't touch it. We got to call NASA. Wait for the, you know, the black trucks to pull up, the white vans. Why, you know what? There's something there that they don't want us to know about. That's right. Here's another quote. This tells it all. There may be a possibility of debris washing up on some of the beaches into some of the areas surrounding the island, says Bill Robel, director of NASA's Wallops Flight Facility, he said in a news conference. If people do find any debris, they should be urged to call NASA at 1-800-WE-BLOW-THINGS-UP. I'm reading it right here. It was in the press release. You think they were wanting those Russian engines now? All right. Enough of the comedy. This is Fade to Black. If you have a story that you want the world to know, email us through jimmychurchradio.com. You can tweet us at jchurchradio. Find us on Facebook, jimmychurchradio.com. Get it to us, jimmy@jimmychurchradio.com. If you can't figure that out by now, you're not that smart. This is Fade to Black. Bespoke radio for the masses. Only on the Dark Matter Radio Network. Keith, we want to get on AFN. What's up? Follow us on Twitter right now, at J Church Radio. Subscribe to the podcast. Obey. I'll be back.
Are you afraid of the dark? Don't move. Don't touch that mouse. You are listening to Fade to Black, bespoke radio for the masses, on jimmychurchradio.com.
Way out here, we listen to Jimmy Church on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
Dark Matter.
Dark Matter.
Dark Matter.
Dark Matter.
Dark Matter.
You're listening to Fade to Black
on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
¿Qué tal, mis amigos? Yo soy Mario Carson, el tiburón, y los invito para que escuchen a mi buen amigo Jimmy Church Radio. ¡Claro que sí!
Oi, oi, I'm Reese Evans, you're listening to Jimmy Church. This is Revolution. The Revolution will not be televised. The Revolution is on radio. Ciao.
Fade to Black, bespoke radio for the masses. I am your so humble host, Jimmy Church. We're only on the Dark Matter Radio Network. Follow us on Twitter at JChurchRadio. You can shoot me an email right now, jimmy@jimmychurchradio.com. And you also, when you follow us on Twitter, hashtag DMRadioNet. I am ready. Day 3 of Halloween week right here on the Dark Matter Radio Network. Father Ashcraft is a set of Vacantist traditional Byzantine Catholic priest and an independent author addressing topics in the realm of the paranormal, historical, and religious issues, cults, the occult, exorcism, demonology. He has been called the Malachi Martin of the 21st century, and he is the founder of the International Society of Religious Demonologists. Father Ashcraft is committed to the traditional and orthodox Christian faith as it had existed before the modernist revolution that began the systematic destruction of the visible church. Father Ashcraft has appeared on a wide variety of media, including the Travel Channel's Ghost Adventures, in episodes such as the Sedumsville Rectory, The Real Exorcist House, and the newest program, Ghost Adventures Aftershocks. He is a frequent guest on syndicated talk radio such as the Jesse Lee Peterson Show, Australia's Sunday Night Saffron, the Mike Siegel Show, Erskine Overnight, the Josh Trolley Show, and many more. Father Ashcraft also is a consultant for Animal Planet's Demon Exorcist. He is listed as one of the 101 priests you should follow. I would like to welcome to the program Father Jack Ashcraft. How are you tonight, Father?
Great, Jimmy. Thanks for having me.
You know, Father, if you don't mind, I don't mean this in any cavalier way at all. Is that how you're normally addressed? It's always Father, or is that a formality?
That's usually how I'm addressed. That's the appropriate etiquette for referring to clergy.
Okay. So I'm not out of line if I just call you Father throughout the show tonight. We're cool.
No, yeah, we're fine.
Okay, all right. Oh, so it's Halloween week, and with your appearances on Ghost Adventures, everybody knows who you are. Does the phone ring more during Halloween in October? Is there more activity out there with demons and people thinking that maybe they need your help?
Yeah, I don't know if there's necessarily more legitimate activity, but there's certainly more claims of activity. people's imaginations get working, and if they're fans of paranormal television, then they're predisposed to considering anything that goes bump in the night as being something spooky.
Right.
See that sort of thing.
And how, for all of us, because with exorcism and demonology and what you do, for most of us, it's a mystery. It's something that we don't necessarily know a whole lot about. you know, where to go, what to do, you know, and what to look for, but also your methodology and how things get done. Take us through that. I mean, you know, when a phone call comes in, and what happens from there? What do you normally do? Do you have assistants? You know what I mean? Right. Do you have a crew? You know, so what happens? You get a phone call, and it's a good one. You raise an eyebrow. What happens next?
Well, the first step that we always take is we ask for a complete synopsis in written form of all claims of activity. And then I pass that on to investigators, lay investigators, people that I have either trained personally or who are professionals in their field. And by that, I mean psychologists, medical doctors, environmental specialists, that sort of thing. And what they do is they make the initial contact and assess the situation. They will look and see if there is anything psychologically happening there, anything medically. And those two are very important to look at because there are a lot of psychological issues that someone could mistake for demonic activity. You know, someone with schizophrenia, for example, that's the most obvious.
Sure.
But then you get into more organic things on the medical side, which can affect psychology, things like temporal lobe epilepsy. You know, one of the most famous cases where there was thought to be some temporal lobe epilepsy would be Whitley Strieber. And he had himself tested during his experiences of what he thought were alien abductions. So, you know, we have to be careful and make sure that we're not dealing with something psychological or medical, especially psychological. You know, if someone is suffering from schizophrenia or temporal lobe epilepsy, and then we reinforce the imagery of the demonic into whatever hallucinatory states that they might experience, then we're doing them more harm than good.
Sure.
And what will ultimately happen is that you could be criminally liable for anything that might happen to them.
Absolutely.
So we approach that very carefully, and we request full psychological and medical evaluations. Then we look at the environment. There are things in a home that could cause the symptoms, hallucinations, in other words, things like contaminated groundwater, certain types of molds, high levels of electromagnetic frequencies and radio waves. And these are things that most people don't consider. But we look at all of these before we even progress to entertaining any question of anything of a preternatural nature going on. Once we've exhausted those, then we will move to look at the specific claims.
Let me jump in real quick. Sure. How fast do you move along? You have to do the evaluations and you have to be thorough with that, but also right. You have a possible exorcism that, you know, that could potentially get worse, or a mental state that could get worse too. So how fast do you progress? Is this like taking days or does it take weeks?
Well, you know, to ensure that we're not dealing with something psychological or medical, those are the first things that we request.
Right.
And so that is in the hands of the psychologist and the medical doctor to handle. And if there's anything abnormal, we'll find out. If not, then we have to know that as well. So that's in the hands of the doctors for how long that would take. Same way with the environmental examination.
Right.
And the testing there. That depends on the specialist, what tests they have to perform, how long those tests take to get done. At any rate, no matter whether the case is valid or invalid, you're not looking at something happening within a few days. In most situations, an exorcism will not be performed quickly. It's something that is very difficult to get done. You need a bishop's permission to do so. The church is very careful about approaching that topic for the reasons we enumerated. And so, you know, it could be anywhere from 6 months to a year before anything's moved on, depending on the level of evidence that we have available.
Can you, that sounds like a long time. What, you know, I don't want to, okay, let's just jump into it a little bit more directly. What if it's a situation where you know that it's an obvious possession? There isn't any mental stuff in, I mean, can you pick up like the bat phone to the bishop and go, look, we've got to move quickly because, you know, her bed is jumping around the bedroom. You know what I mean? It is out of control.
If there is no question in my mind that we have an actual case of demonic possession, then yes, I can contact my bishop directly and expedite the situation. I can get it taken care of a lot more quickly.
You and I were talking earlier today, and with and again, I don't want to make light of this, but the movie The Exorcist certainly did bring all of this to the public eye. And I know that you remember back then, it seemed like on the cover of every newspaper in the country, somebody was possessed in some city, right? Everybody, there was exorcisms going on everywhere. And not to make light of it, but it certainly brought it to the public's attention. But it was also Hollywood. The movie was Hollywood. Has there ever been a case like that out of control with the possession? You know, moving objects and
yes,
the priest being affected too as well.
Well, you know, some of the extraordinary examples are objects moving, things being thrown around the room, stuff like that. Those things do occur, yes. Are they normative? No. But they are frequent enough that we expect them. However, you know, the more extreme things of Hollywood, you know, the head spinning around, that sort of thing, you know, that, again, as you noted, you're dealing with Hollywood and there's an entertainment value there. They're trying to scare people for the entertainment value. So that sort of thing doesn't occur.
Right.
But certainly body contortions, speaking in unknown languages, having a knowledge of things that were secret, the person would never have had any reason to know. Those things do occur, certainly.
What is the... okay, go ahead. I'm sorry.
As far as the priest himself being affected, there have been cases where, you know, the priest has been attacked, where his, you know, I know of a couple of cases where a priest was attacked in his home afterwards by an entity. Another one whose car inexplicably was pulled off the road and he had an auto accident. So, you know, those things do happen, but they're rare.
What is the reason? What is the reason for possession? Is it because the underworld is trying to get up here to us, you know, one person at a time, and it's their only way out of the gates of Hades, so to speak? You know, why would a demon possess a body?
Well, for torment, that's the easiest and simplest answer. And that's the first answer given. When a person, and it needs to be said that when a person is possessed, that means they have gone through a prolonged period of time where the demonic has been active in their life and they've not done anything to address the spiritual situation. Demonic activity operates on three basic levels: oppression, obsession, and then possession. And generally, it will move through those phases, those levels,
mm-hmm,
progressively getting worse. And it's for the purpose of tormenting the person because they've, you know, starting with oppression, they've tormented them from without. Oppression is one of the best examples people are probably familiar with is Job in the Old Testament, who was oppressed and tortured by Satan from without, lost everything he owned, lost all of his children, his livestock. I mean, literally, even his body was racked with pain and sores. That is a classical biblical case of oppression. Then you move into obsession. And obsession is, it's like temptation multiplied by thousands. You know, we're all tempted every day to do little things that we shouldn't and we know that are sinful. But obsession is where those temptations become diabolic. They're magnified intensely and they're constant. And the demonic will present situations for us to indulge those areas of sin so that the person is increasingly demoralized and moved out of the sanctifying grace of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And so once having moved somebody to a point of despair, which is usually what happens once you get into the obsessive state, then that generally will leave them open to possession. That doesn't mean that everyone has to go through all of those phases. There are cases like the story that of that the movie The Exorcist was based on, the real story there. The boy and his grandmother used to play with a Ouija board. But when grandmother died, he missed grandma and he tried to contact her. The boy didn't go through the first two phases because he had opened the doorway immediately.
Right.
By use of the Ouija board. So those are the general specifications.
Do you have to be religious to be possessed? In other words, what if somebody was not religious at all? Would a demon be interested in them, or are they only interested in somebody that would be religious? Because it seems like it's always a religious family, the, you know, strong foundations, you know, the go to church every Sunday or Saturday or what have you.
Yeah.
So would a demon be interested in somebody that was an atheist?
Well, I want to preface this by saying that there are cases where atheists have found themselves possessed.
Wow.
But it's not common. And the reason is that the demonic is not really concerned with an atheist. The atheist is no danger to their general goal, which is the demoralization of humanity, taking humanity to hell with them.
Right.
An atheist is no obstacle to that goal. It is generally those who are of some sort of faith that are an obstacle to that. And so they're the ones that are more likely to be attacked. But, you know, you hear about Christians being possessed. I'm not of the mind that a person who is really, truly a committed Christian can be possessed. Because the Holy Spirit cannot dwell in the same place as the demonic. You can't have the clean and the unclean together. House divided against itself cannot stand.
Then how would a priest become possessed? His faith is cracked in some way? There's an opening. There's an opening for
it. I don't know of any who have.
Okay.
But if they did, it would be because they have left the sanctifying grace of Christ. They're deeply involved in sin or deeply involved in the occult.
Right.
Something like that. And it's the same with anyone. You know, nowadays we live in a society where anybody can claim to be pretty much anything. They can claim to be a Christian, and it's really a nominal thing. Yeah, I'm a Christian because, well, my grandparents were Christians, and we went to church when I was a kid. And so they're not really believers. They have no real substantive relationship with Christ. And so they are Christian in name only, and so they're susceptible to attack. So that's probably why you see people of faith get attacked in that way.
When, how do you go about defining an actual possession? I mean, what defines that?
Well, we look for very specific signs, and I mentioned some of them earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking an unknown language, a language the person has no possibility of having ever been exposed to or knowing, even more so a dead language. You know, we will turn to people who are specialists in like ancient Near Eastern languages. And, you know, if we get a recording of some odd speech coming from someone who's claiming to be possessed, turn that over to one of these specialists. And if they can identify the language, then we've got a pretty good case for demonic possession there. Because, you know, the people who speak ancient Near Eastern languages are few and far between. and it's probably not going to be a 14-year-old girl in the middle of Kansas.
Right, right, right. And that must absolutely, well, it's your job. It's what you do. But when it comes to that point, it must really, I can't think of another way to put this, really freak you out. And how do you handle that when you have an obvious state, somebody speaking, like you said, some language that maybe not even the specialist even know, that there's no possibility. How do you deal with that? Do you just move forward? Are you in shock? I can't imagine what mentally you're going through at that point.
Yeah. I mean, the more experienced you become, the less shocked at those things that you're likely to be. With those sorts of things, you put them in your evidence box and you move forward. And you look for other evidences.
Wow.
An aversion to holy places and holy things. That's another one. And it's not simply that. I mean, people can lie and people are very creative. And so, you know, you have to be careful. And there are certain tests that we will use to sort of ferret out lies from truth. And I'll share one of them. And it's a very simple one. The use of holy water. Now, most people would think, well, you can pretend that the holy water is bothering you if you're a good actor. And you certainly can. However, what we do is, without any knowledge, of it on the victim's part or the claimant's part, we'll have one bottle that says holy water filled with tap water and the other one with holy water. And we use those intermittently and see which one we get a consistent response to. If we get a consistent response to the holy water, then it's more likely we're dealing with something legitimate.
But you're a father. You're not supposed to be deceiving. Playing tricks on the devil. Yeah, that's good stuff. Okay.
Playing tricks on potential life.
Yes, right. Well, it would be both at that point. Yeah. Interesting. We're nearly at the end of this. I want to, you have an open invitation. We've got to get you back on and we'll spend a whole lot of time talking about whatever. But we were talking earlier, your last case that you worked on wasn't the possession of a body or a soul, but the possession of a house. Can you just tell us about that? And so it's a possessed house. Is that a haunted house? Is it the same thing?
Yeah, because we do not view ghosts as being anything other than the manifestation of the demonic. It was Sudansville Rectory.
What? Stop. I'm so sorry. You just said ghosts. You consider ghosts to be, don't skate past that. You just said you consider ghosts. Father.
Yes.
You said you had a definition for ghosts. You just said.
Yes. They're a manifestation of the demonic. They are not the spirits of the deceased.
Whoa. Okay. I'm writing that down. Really? Really?
Demonic entities will masquerade as the spirits of the dead in order to mislead people into believing things that are not true, antithetical to sacred scripture, and to lead them into occultism, if possible. And it's a brilliant, brilliant method, because with the rise of paranormal television and people all wanting to be ghost hunters,
right?
They've imbibed occult theories and ideologies without even realizing it.
So when you're on Ghost Adventures and you're running around with Zach and his crew, those guys are probably not being very smart. Is that what you're saying?
No, and they would tell you that I've told them numerous times they need to stop doing what they're doing, because even if they're not encountering anything, 99 times out of 100, it's that one time that they might find something, and it's really going to do some damage, because their methodology is haphazard, it's foolish, and they play with things they shouldn't.
I knew it. We're going to get Zach on the show, and I'm going to ask him that exact question. Do you actually think you're doing the right thing? Sometimes I wonder, and you can tell that that they're affected. Sometimes they're affected mentally. They're affected, and yeah, you can tell that that is.
I think they're sincere.
Definitely. Zach, they're definitely sincere.
I think they're sincere men. And I do think there's a degree of concern for the people who come to them. But, you know, the nature of what their business is that they're not able to give aftercare, and they're not equipped to handle even the darker aspects of the very nature of the work they do. But they play with fire. I understand recently on a recent episode, they broke out a Ouija board and tried to contact the demon. I mean, that's just foolishness.
Yeah. Our next guest tonight is Tracy Twyman. And I don't know if you know Tracy or her work, but that's what she has been doing for the last 15 years. And has a book out about it. It's a pretty fascinating subject. And me, there's no over at the church house. You know, that's my last name. Oh, it's kind of funny when you and I were exchanging emails. I won't bring that up. But there's no Ouija boards over at the church house. Oh, no. And there never will be. Somebody posted the other day on Facebook, I saw a little girl's pink, like Barbie Ouija set that you can buy with a little pink planchette, and it comes in a pink box. I'm like, what? Look at what they're doing. They're marketing, you know, to 2 or 3 year old girls that are walking through Toys R Us with their parents and see the pink Ouija board box. They don't know what it is. It's pink. So they have to have it. And that's just disturbing on so many different levels. We didn't get to, okay, can you give us the 60-second version of the house that was possessed and what happened and did you get rid of it? Were you successful?
It was Sidangelo Rectory in Cincinnati, Ohio. And it was the first time I appeared on Ghost Adventures. It's an old rectory. A lot of abuse happened in the home, apparently sexual abuse of children, by the Roman Catholic priest who was there. He had confessed to it just before he passed away. Apparently some illegal dog fighting was going on in the property as well. And, so when I showed up, they asked me to do a blessing on the property, which is what I did. And then that contains a what's called a simple exorcism. It's not a formal one, but it does the job nonetheless. Saw a dark figure on the second floor when I went up there, and it was definitely in one room a distinct smell of sulfur. And we searched for a possible source for it throughout the property. Couldn't find any, but once I blessed that room where that smell was, it dissipated quickly. And every reputable investigator that I know who has gone there after that. They said there was nothing there anymore. So, indeed, it was successful.
I have to thank you for coming on the show tonight. And let's get you back on with this in about a month or so. And we'll spend a couple of hours with us. Okay?
That would be my honor.
No, the honor is all mine. Thank you. Father Jack Ashcraft. You can go to, tell everybody, it's so cool. What is the name of your website?
TrueExorcist.com.
That's what I'm talking about. And when you come back on, you've got to, I don't want you to take the time now, but you've got to tell us how you got your nickname. And
yeah,
okay. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. All right. Father Jack Ashcraft. Thank you, Father. You have a great night and have a safe Halloween.
You too. And God bless.
All the best. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Father Jack Ashcraft, man, that's the real deal right there. Thank you for coming on with us. We had some technical issues yesterday, and he came on with us tonight for a little bit. So there you go. All right. So with that, let's take a quick break. When I come back, we'll be joined with Tracy Twyman. Oh, yeah. Ouija boards all night. Stay with us. This is Fade to Black, only on the Dark Matter Radio Network. Shoot me an email, Jimmy at JimmyChurchRadio.com. Follow us on Twitter right now at JChurchRadio. I'll be back right after this.
Hi, everybody. This is Rob Halford, the Metal God, on JimmyChurchRadio.com.
What's up? My name's Brian Taylor, Ninja Badass Extraordinaire, and this is JimmyChurchRadio.com.
JJCR in your face.
JimmyChurchRadio.com
on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
Oh, yeah, Fade to Black. Only on the Dark Matter Radio Network. Day 3 of Halloween week. It is all good. Thank you, Father Ashcraft. That was absolutely amazing. Follow us on Twitter right now, at JChurchRadio. Hashtag DMRadioNet. Come hang out with the other Fader Knots in the sandbox. Shoot me an email to Jimmy at JimmyChurchRadio.com. And let's just keep this moving right along. Tracy Twyman is an American nonfiction author born in Kansas City, Missouri. She writes about esoteric history. Her most well-known books, including the Merovingian. See, I just knew that was happening. Mythos, Solomon's Treasure, and I apologize for that. Sometimes, Tracy, I get tongue twisted. It's called too much Starbucks before the show. And Money Grows on the Tree of Knowledge. Before writing books, she made a name for herself as the editor and publisher of a highly unique magazine entitled Dagobert's Revenge, which was published between 1996 and 2003. She has appeared on several radio shows, television shows, and film documentaries. Most notably, she has been interviewed on National Geographic's If It Is Real, Da Vinci's Code in 2006, Jesse Ventura's Conspiracy Theory, and the documentary film Bloodline, which, by the way, I've seen a few times. Absolutely amazing. She's a regular on the national radio show and our friend, Ground Zero with Clyde Lewis. And also, and you've been on Coast to Coast as well, but now you work for Clyde, don't you, Tracy? Welcome to the program.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate the invitation. It's nice to be on your show. And yeah, I'm sitting in the Ground Zero offices right now doing this interview.
So what you should do, this is what you do. Walk into the studio right now with your phone and go, Church wants to say hi, Clyde. Let's interrupt. Can we do that? Not a good idea. Oh, see, you need to be crazy, Tracy. Oh, man. Yeah, love Clyde.
Started here. I really don't want to get fired.
Not yet. How's he doing, by the way? He got out of the hospital yesterday. Is he bright-eyed and bushy-tailed today, and he looks good?
He looks great. I mean, I started working here a couple of weeks ago, and he's been lethargic feeling and sort of droopy-eyed, I guess. I don't know. It's just not the normal Clyde ever since a couple weeks ago. And then he went into the hospital, and it turned out he had internal bleeding, and they put some blood in him. And all of a sudden, he pricked it right up again. You know, I guess he just needed to have an adequate blood supply, and it's the old Clyde again. So he's doing quite well.
You know what comes to mind? Vampire. I knew it. I knew that about Clyde. I knew that.
He just needs green blood.
I knew that. All right. Well, it's not about Clyde. It's about you, Tracy. Welcome to the program. We're very happy that Clyde is, you know, we need Clyde, and he knows that. And this is a very small community, and he's part of that. And always, you know, I call him way too much. I'm concerned, you know, I want to know. You all right, brother? Okay, that's it. Clyde, we're moving on. Your new book. Now, there's, I don't know where to start with you. I don't know if you just heard Father Ashcraft and his warning of Ouija boards, but certainly I think with
I've
you,
heard all of those.
Yeah, well, you know, there's
I've been warned so many times, but I guess it just never really stuck with me. I'm not scared after all this time. I'm still not scared.
And with who you've been talking to, you should be scared, but we'll get into all of that, in just a second. With Father Ashcraft, you just heard his warning, and I don't have a Ouija board over at the house either. And your communications and everything else, and how it's documented in your new book. Actually, before we go there, where did the name come from? Because I actually did an internet search, and I came up with Nada. It's such a unique title for a book, and I just thought, wow, that is really cool. And
I am very proud of myself, because you see how difficult it was to read the titles of my previous books. And I have had this problem my whole life. I just can't come up with a title that anyone else can pronounce.
Right.
And I've been struggling, you know, it really affects your commercial sales when people don't know how to say or write the title of the book, which, I mean, some of my other books have sold well, but I think in spite of that. So I'm very glad that this time I actually came up with just two words that actually everyone can say, even though they may not have heard that phrase before. And I myself had not heard of it. I didn't know what a shaving of a clock was. As far as I can tell, we're talking about if you had a clock, you know, with metal gears, that there would be little metal shavings or, you know, filings that might fall down from it and be collected. But where the title actually comes from, this quotation from an anthropology book that was published in 1921. The lady's name was Dr. Margaret Alice Murray, and the book was called The God of the Witches. And if you'd like, I could just read you the quotation, and that'll give everyone a clue as to what we're talking about here.
Absolutely. You know what? While you're dialing up that quote, this is what I got from it. I didn't and I'm a black and white guy too, so I see the literal sense that you're talking about, you know, shavings of metal, maybe the gears, the workings of the clock. But to me, it hits me more of something that you can't touch, that maybe it's dealing with time. Maybe it's the shavings of time. And that's,
well, it is in a way.
Oh, okay. All right.
I didn't mean to interrupt you.
No, you didn't interrupt at all. It is such a confusing, cool two words, you know, clock shavings. They don't even go together. And so I went completely out of the box with it. The easy part is, yeah, shavings of a clock. Yeah. Take a cheese grater and shave it down. I see that. But no, I'm thinking more of something more esoteric. Maybe it was dealing with pieces of time. So read the quote. I'd love to hear it.
Okay. Sure. Yeah. The quote says this: the Swedish witches had a special rite, which was obviously intended to impress ignorant minds. They were given a little bag containing a few shavings of a clock to which a stone was tied. They threw this into the water saying, as these shavings of the clock do never return to the clock from which they are taken, so may my soul never return to heaven. And this quote you're right. It's so rarely referenced. I was really glad to see that not a lot of people had used this on the internet yet. So the only other piece of artwork that I know of that references that quote from Dr. Margaret Alice Murray is this Coven album. There was this band that it was like a proto metal band in the 70s, and most of the stuff they did was satanic rock, and some of the first satanic rock. But you may know them as the band that did One Tin Soldier. It was used in the Billy Jack movie. So they had that one hit, and then they had all these satanic songs, and one of them was actually the first satanic mass that was ever recorded prior to actually Anton LaVey releasing one a few years later. So this band, Coven, yeah, like I said, is the only, they produced the only work of art that I know that actually referenced that quote. They actually, in the satanic mass that they performed the audio of and put out on the record the audio of the satanic mass, they actually had the woman who was being inducted to the satanic group. She had to say that phrase. She said, you know, that I basically am giving up my soul to Satan. And, you know, just like these clocks won't return, these shavings won't return to the clock. Therefore, my soul won't return to heaven. So and when you talk about time, I think it is related in some way in that it's like the time that you would have spent in heaven, basically, has been taken away from you.
Exactly.
And I think also literally, if you recall the story of Faust or Faustus, you know, there was the Marlowe version and then there was the Goethe version. But in both instances, he made this deal where there was 24 years. He said, Mephistopheles, please have the devil grant me whatever I want for the next 24 years and then I'll give my soul up. So, and then what you see in the story is it all goes very quickly from that point onward. And he's actually sort of in a dreamlike state. And it's almost like the things that happen to him aren't real. So he has all of his wishes granted, but they're really all illusions. He's given Helen of Troy, supposedly, as a bride. And it turns out that she's really just an apparition and an illusion. And there's some other things that happen. Like he makes, I think it was the king of Germany or something, rich. He makes his kingdom rich, and it turns out the way they did that, it was Mephistopheles' suggestion to use fiat currency or, you know, money backed by nothing.
Right, right.
In order
right.
to make the kingdom rich. And that turns out to be an illusion, too. So,
right, right.
Anyway,
right.
I guess I'm just saying, like, it's about really a Faustian pact in a way and how it takes the sort of effect that it has on the time that you have left, I guess. I'm not saying in the book that I necessarily did that, but sometimes I'm afraid that maybe I did, and that could account for how unsure I am, actually. The reason why I'm unsure is maybe because everything, you know, I'm in that unreal state. I'm in that state of not being really here anymore because my soul is actually on the other side. I hope not. I mean, that's not what I want to do, but sometimes I'm afraid that that might have happened.
Right, right. Okay, with Baphomet. And I don't want to jump too far ahead, but we all know who Cain was. So, I want to hear from you with Baphomet. To me, he's a very whatever Baphomet is, and I kind of said this leading into the show, whether it's a person, a demon, or a thing, it really hasn't been too clearly defined throughout history. We certainly have the images of Baphomet. But I don't know if it's modern or if Baphomet actually goes back, you know, to the Old Testament or references, you know, to 5,000-7,000 years ago. I meant to ask Father Ashcraft directly, you know, here we had some clergy on the show, you know, how do they look at Baphomet? So for you and your communication with Baphomet, who is Baphomet? Is it something that's 10,000 years old, a person, a thing that turned into a demon, or is it something more modern and, you know, directly connected to, you know, it's, let's say, Aleister Crowley and is more of a modern phenomenon? Who is Baphomet?
Well, I would say that like many occult egregores, it's something that actually gets built on over time. And none of those aspects of this concept are unreal. They're all actually part of it. And so I would say, I could tell you what he told us. And I did not ask to talk to Baphomet. I was told to talk to Baphomet by Cain. But at any rate, I asked at one point Baphomet, what are you? And he identified himself with the head. He said head, spelled out that word. And then I asked a little bit more, and sure enough, he said that, yes, he was a skull or a severed head that was used as an idol by the Templars. They used it, the Knights Templar, of course. They used it for the same reason I would use a Ouija board, for divination purposes. So they had this head, which is referred to as the head of prophecy, because it was, he said, it was in fact John the Baptist's head, which is one of the rumors that's been around for a while, one of the traditions.
Right.
And in fact, the Templars did make, John the Baptist was like their patron saint, and they did use the symbol of the skull and crossbones and the symbol of John's head in some of their own iconography. So it's not surprising, really, to see that this is really what it was, according to Baphomet himself.
Did the Knights Templar, sorry for interrupting. I thought I had a little break in there. I was squeezing in. Did the Knights Templar refer to Baphomet by name?
Well, what we have is the records of their confessions when they were arrested and prosecuted for blasphemy and heresy. And so a lot of them did make confessions, sometimes under duress, you know, under torture and things like that. But the thing is that the confessions are so consistent, really, from person to person, that you really got to think that there's a line of continuity here. They really are, you know, telling the truth to a certain extent. So what they said, yeah, they used the word Baphomet. And as far as we can tell, that's really the first time that word ever came into the historical record. But I think that the concept does go back further. So I think that they basically tapped into something, a relic like John the Baptist's head, that was a touch point that connected them to a much older concept, which I would, just to summarize it very quickly, I think this is the serpent in the Garden of Eden. And there's a Jewish Kabbalist tradition about that serpent being a hermaphroditic being, the union of two different, a male and female demon. And I think that's why later Baphomet came to be depicted as a hermaphroditic being with a goat head. The goat head connects, I think, to Azazel, who's a goat demon mentioned in the Bible.
Now, with your, for the audience, we need to get some historical perspective going here. Your communication, well, it didn't start with a Ouija board, I don't think, but you can clear that up for us. But take us back. This has been going on, for 13, 15 years now.
Yeah, it started in the summer of 2001, shortly after, I can't remember if it was before or after 9/11, which, would sort of orient things for me. But at any rate, it was around that time, and basically, I guess the spirit communication had started long before that, but I didn't really understand it. It was inspiration, because, of course, I had been a writer and tried all sorts of different projects when I was a teenager, and so when I was about 18 years old, I suddenly got this idea to create the magazine you mentioned earlier, which was Dagobert's Revenge, and that was all about the Merovingian bloodline. It was all about this, what's called the Grail bloodline, which was written about in the Da Vinci Code and lots of other popular books, supposedly a line descended from Jesus and supposedly basically magical and divine. There's a secret society called the Priory of Zion that's just totally about this bloodline and bringing it back to a seat of power, actually. So anyway, I had done a magazine all about this subject. It seems like such a strange thing, a strange idea to even come up with, much less actually put the work and the investment, the monetary investment and otherwise that I put into it over the next few years. But it was really because I was very inspired to do this. And I was told by some voice in my head, really, that I should do this. And at every step of the way, I felt really pushed and compelled to do this. And, you know, again, I just thought at the time, well, this is artistic inspiration, but I knew that it was a stronger form than I had experienced before. And sure enough, that project took off like nothing I had ever done before and really led to everything else that happened after that. I hooked up with some other writers. We started doing some very serious research into those subjects. And it was because of that, that we wanted me and I guess another person who ended up being my husband, we decided one night that we would contact Jean Cocteau on the Ouija board. Jean Cocteau is a French artist and filmmaker and poet that was active in the earlier part of the 20th century. And he was supposedly one of the grand masters of this secret society I mentioned called the Priory of Zion.
Mm-hmm.
And so just to shed some light on the research that we were doing, and because I had read in Cocteau's biography that he had a history of doing seances in, with a technology that they used to call table rapping, which is what happened, what people used to do before Ouija boards were invented.
Mm-hmm.
And so I read about him doing that, and I just thought, well, if he did that when he was alive, maybe he would like to do it after he's dead. You know, maybe he will communicate with us. And it was really just on a whim. One night, my soon-to-be husband had moved into an apartment with me, and he was just going through some boxes, and he found a Ouija board, and we just came up with this idea. But it just worked right away. But the messages weren't totally useful to us. We were basically told that he couldn't help us very much.
I'm so glad we're talking. Now I get to answer. I ask you all these. I've had questions for you for such a long time. Let's stop right there. Okay, let's pick this apart. You contact Jean Cocteau. Yeah. And from that very instant right there, what happened? What was the first question that you asked him? And how did you know that it was actually Cocteau?
Well, I guess you could say that about any of the people or entities that I talked to. You know, I wasn't able to ask for a driver's license or anything to verify their identity, but just, you know, I asked, you know, Cocteau, are you there? And the device we were using at the time, which was actually an empty bottle of cumin spice, because we didn't have a regular planchette at the time, it just started wobbling around in such a way we could tell it wasn't coming from us. And at one point, it was actually moving just slightly, a few centimeters really, or maybe 1 or 2 centimeters away from our hands. We could tell that there was some force that was coming through our hands, but pushing it and actually projecting from our fingertips a little bit. So, we just could tell, we could feel it, and then it started saying things, mostly number and letter codes that didn't make any sense.
Well, also,
stuff in French.
Yeah, that's my question. It must have been in French, right?
Some of it was in French. Some of it was just numbers and letters that don't make any sense, which I found out later all of the spirits do when they don't know what to say or they can't tell you what you're asking. So we had to ask, you know, several times, what does all this mean? And eventually we got this message that was, you know, on a regular Ouija board, the one you would buy at the store, the one made by Parker Brothers, in the right and left bottom corners, there's a little picture of someone using a Ouija board. And you can, there's like, I think 2 people, they have their hands on the planchette, they're touching it. And then you can see over their shoulder, a little spirit hovering there. And so what he would do is he would go to that spirit, the little spirit hovering over the woman's shoulder, to indicate that he was having a hard time communicating. At one point he spelled out the words, I am blocked. I am blocked for you.
Whoa. How were you at this point? Did you have a third person in the room documenting? I mean, it must have been writing stuff down, or were you committed to memory? How did you remember the numbers? And it's in French, and it's a language you probably don't speak. Well, I don't know if you do, but you know, it's not in English. So how were you documenting everything?
Well, I've got audio recordings of the Cocteau ones, and then I think I have a video of the last Cocteau seance where he told us just to talk to Cain instead. We have that, and then I also was taking notes, you know, after each question, I would try to write down everything he had said. And then finally, we did get joined by some other people that would, you know, so we would have a scribe so that I wouldn't have to stop and do that all the time.
Right.
The way see, it's so foggy for me now because actually the cocktail stuff, it seems like such a big deal at the time. And yet once we got to start talking to Cain, it was a whole different world. You know, that's when we really got started. So Cocteau, in my mind, just the way I remember it, is he had a hard time speaking, basically told us, you know, he couldn't communicate very well and that the answers that we were seeking were better sought by contacting Cain, who he referred to as the Black Sun. And it took us a while to figure out that's what he meant. Actually, for a while, he kept saying, see the sun, just over and over again, every time we would ask something that he didn't have an answer to or it wasn't easy for him to say the answer.
Was it sun, S-U-N, or sun, S-O-N?
Well, he would go up to the sun symbol on the board, because there's a sun and a moon symbol on either side of on the top of the board.
And I got 5,000 questions, Tracy. With Cain, and by the way, everybody calling in, all the if we get around to phone calls tonight, I'll announce open lines. Okay, the phone calls are stacked, and it keeps clicking on and off in front of me. So I'll just let everybody know I'm not going to pick up. Okay, I'm not going to put you on hold. We'll open up the phone lines if we can in about an hour. Okay, now with Cain, how did you? Two questions, and let's just bang this out. How did you find out it was Cain? Cain, as in Cain and Abel. One and two. What language was Cain speaking?
Okay, well, the reason why we knew it was Cain was because I and some of the other people I was working with had been doing research into that subject. Actually, already we had discovered, the way we saw it from the sources we were using, one of which was a guy named L.A. Waddell, who's one of the earliest Sumeriologists, studiers of ancient Sumer, you know, back in the 1920s when he was writing. It had just been discovered, all that Sumerian stuff, and they were just getting around to analyzing it. So this guy wrote a book where he basically thought that he posited that Cain was actually this figure that you find in the king's list of the Sumerians, and also he connected it to the king's list, the ancient pre-Diluvian king's list of the Egyptians and Babylonians, Chaldeans. I mean, he went through all these ancient cultures and said one of the first kings was actually the same guy that's recorded in the Bible as Cain. And so in these other traditions, his name is sometimes Khan or Can. But he's, again, one of the first kings. The way that they describe him is basically that he was a part of some large empire that had other, you know, tribute nations that they had country that he was a king of had colonized. And we had connected this really to the kingdom of Atlantis, it seemed to us that all those stories were, again, stories of this ancient civilization that went back before the flood, and that the kings of this ancient civilization had at the very least been remembered as gods or demigods. And, you know, it connects obviously to the stories in the Bible about the angels coming down and breeding with the humans to create the Nephilim giants. Our theory was basically that, yes, that did happen. The progeny of that were the first kings of the ancient world. The flood was the attempt to wipe that race out, but they did continue onward after that. And so, basically, yeah, we had this idea that Cain was this very important figure in history. And one of the symbols that we connected him to was the Black Sun, which is something that a lot of Asian cultures talk about, this orb, the idea that there's this sun kind of in the center of the earth or in the underworld beneath our feet, and that it's, you know, instead of, obviously, the sun in the sky is yellow or golden, this one is black, and it puts out a kind of dark energy. It's not really a sun in the traditional sense, but that's what it's called, because down in the underworld, it's their source of light. So, I mean, it's all complicated, I know, but at any rate, we were doing this research, and that's what we knew about Cain. And when Cocteau kept saying, see the sun, finally we had to ask, is that what you're talking about? And it's then it all opened up for us.
Did he ever define himself directly?
Cain, as being the Black Sun, you mean?
Yes, and did he mention Abel? Did he mention any of the old stories in the Bible to clearly define himself? How did he do that?
Yes. We had a great long discussion with him actually about the war in what he calls the war in Eden, which he described as being the same as the fall of Atlantis. And he told us all about that there was, remember I was saying that there were these other countries basically that were tributes or subjects of this main kingdom that Cain was the king of. Well, he said that was Eden, that there was it was ruled over by the throne of Adam, as he described it. He was the rightful heir to the throne of Adam, but there were these other kingdoms that were actually, he said, ruled by children of his own descendants, but they rebelled and tried to take the throne of Eden. And attached to the throne of Eden, he said, was this thing called the Ark. And he described it as, quote, the one box of things. He said that this was like the treasure in the universe, you know, or maybe at least in our world, that it basically literally contains this godlike power, this transformational power, what you could equate to the Philosopher's Stone of the alchemists. He said that was somehow contained within this Ark, and that the king of Eden, sitting on the throne of Adam, possesses this Ark, and this is what sort of allows him to have power, to be the king of the world, as he described it. And so, he told us all about this war that they had. He said it was fought with swords and axes. And he said that these rebellious kings of the subject nations, he called them the Dohir kings. He said it meant the kings of the fallen land. And he gave us the names of them, ten names. And he described the whole war. And he said it ended up with the flood, that's the way the whole situation ended, that large parts of Eden ended up being, subsumed underwater, where they collapsed underneath the waves. And he also actually said that this was something he had done, that he had done some sort of magical or alchemical ritual because he was so angry at these descendants of his that were rebelling. And so he called it the Wrath of Cain.
And that's when he was...
I know there's a Star Wars movie called that, or Star Trek or something like that. Wrath of Khan.
Wrath of Khan.
Anyway, that's what he called it.
Now, was this when he was still physical? He was alive?
Yes. So this whole war happened while he was physical and alive. But the result of that, the result of the Wrath of Cain, was not only the flood, but also that's when he and his cohorts, the team he had working with him, ended up being locked into the abyss by God, I presume. And so that's where he was speaking to us from when we were talking to him on the Ouija board. We asked him, because he had identified himself as the Black Sun. So we said, are you in the center of the earth right now? He said, yes. And then he described that he was inside of what he called a prism, like a crystal, that there was energy radiating through it. And that's what caused the Black Sun effect. And that he was also asleep. He said, I am not alive. He said it in Spanish, actually. He said, soy no vive, because my husband, the guy I was working with, knew a bit of Spanish. And so he just decided to say it in Spanish instead.
That's interesting. Real quick, did he describe does he hold a position now on the other side? I mean, is he a king of spirits? What does he do now?
Well, for one thing, he described himself as sort of being in a death-like sleep. He's not really alive or dead. You know, he's, an undead, a vampire in a way. And literally, actually, because recently we had a conversation with him where he talked about drinking blood. But I'll get into that later, maybe.
Okay. Whoa. Okay, hold on. Okay, continue. I'm writing that one down. We're coming back to that.
Okay, sure. Actually, I have a lot to say about that subject. But so he did say that he was dreaming, basically, and that I was You know, I'm talking to him in a dream, which is why sometimes he would go foggy too. You know, sometimes he would kind of blur out. He would not be able to answer a question for a while, but then he would come back. And I would ask him, why are you doing that? And he would say sometimes words like fog or haze.
Would the planchet, are you saying the planchet would like slow down?
It would, a lot of times he'd start misspelling words, or it would kind of, trail off after, in the middle of a sentence, and we'd have to kind of goad him to get him back.
Slur his speech, so to speak. Point. Yeah, slur his speech.
Yes.
Okay.
And so, really, you know, it's funny, at the time, I guess I still, because, I don't know, I was just so knee-deep in all sorts of esoterica and different viewpoints, I guess, on biblical subjects. I guess you could call them Gnostic or even Luciferian points of view. So it didn't even really occur to me to ask him some of the basic questions about what's it like being in the underworld and is it actually hell? And it took a while for me to get around to asking those questions, and I did get some more description of that if you wanted, but I got it later on, several years into this thing. So,
okay.
I mean, if you want to know what it's like in hell, I can tell you all
we're,
that.
We're going right there. Trust me. It is Halloween week, Tracy. So,
okay.
But you just mentioned that you talked to him recently. When was the last time you spoke to Cain? Yesterday?
No, probably 2 months ago, maybe.
Wow. And so what do? Do you sit down? I'm not making light of this at all. I mean, I'm fascinated. Mm-hmm. Do you just sit down and dial up Cain?
Pretty much. I mean, I used to do spooky music and incense and stuff for a while, really meditate to try to get into the mood. But over time, I got so practiced at it that I really don't have to do that much anymore. I think I'm very able to tap into it quickly now.
Does he call you by name? Does he say, hey, Tracy, I'm here? Seriously?
I think I've had him use my name once, but I don't know. I just never asked ask him if he knew my name or anything, but I've been with other people who were interested in that. They I think were skeptical. And so they asked, do you know what my name is? Do you know this or that about me? And mostly got correct answers. So I know he knows who I am.
Yeah. First name basis with Cain. That's pretty cool. I mean, wow. Okay. I'm very rarely at a loss for words, but that's pretty incredible. Okay. Let's back up. So now
you're
conversing with Cain, and were you able to just ask really direct questions, and were the answers coming back fairly easily, and was there anything that he refused to answer or talk about?
All of those things. Yes, I could ask anything I wanted to, of course. What I would usually get a useful response, but sometimes I wouldn't. He would usually speak in English, but frequently drop words from other languages, including Sumerian. Usually I would not recognize the Sumerian word. So I would just end up writing it down, usually thinking it's nonsense. And then I would end up looking it up and find out, oh, that's a Sumerian word. And then there were some others that I was not able to find a record of historically, but they still seem like words, you know, they just still really look like actual words to me. And so there were two languages other than regular historical ones. You know, ones that people have heard of. There were two languages that he spoke that I thought were very unique. Whenever I would find a word that I didn't know the meaning of, but it seemed like a word, sometimes I would ask him, what language is that in? And so he would say either Aryan, and by that he meant the Sumerian language.
Sure.
Like he was talking about this ancient... anyway, so he... A lot of his words were in Aryan, as he said. And then... he also referred, or actually Baphomet talked about this, but they all know about it. They talk about the language of light, as they call it. And we were told that that is what the angels speak. God knows how to speak it. This is a language that's used by beings that are more than human.
Which is, so anyway, what are you saying? Ahead. So God and angels speak in Sumerian?
Well, I don't know. I think I'm not sure if the language of light and the Aryan language are really the same. I just know that there were some words that I asked Baphomet about what is that language, and he said it was the language of light. And then the message about the language of light came a few more times, so we know that it's something that they refer to. It's a term that they use.
Did you ever ask Cain, again, I'm not making light of this at all, but did you ever ask Cain about God?
Oh, yes, yes. And actually, the messages about God came before I ever asked them.
Okay.
And there's some things you might ask, like, why didn't you ask this stuff? I don't know. I was busy. Busy talking sure. about what we were already talking about. So it took a while.
Right.
But eventually, yeah, we started getting messages about God. And, well, I don't know if you want to get into the Baphomet stuff, because it was probably Baphomet that told me the most about God.
Okay. Well, let's stay on Cain first, because Baphomet sure. is just going to freak me out. So let's keep Baphomet all in one group. But with Cain specifically, what did he say about God?
Well, I guess some of the most recent stuff was probably the most interesting. Okay, Cain said, I know you wanted to, we were going to talk about the blood drinking later, but I might as well just say it now. Cain identified himself as an Amalek. He said that there was this whole race of Amaleks, and he was one of them. I had to look it up, and sure enough, it's a Hebrew word. It's just another one of the Hebrew words for the giants, or maybe a particular race of giants.
Anunnaki? Are we going Anunnaki? Are we going Nephilim here?
We're going Nephilim. And Anunnaki. But I don't know. I don't know the specifics of whether there were how many races of giants, or if there were different nuances of the various races. But at any rate, he told me that he was an Amalek, right? And this is recent, again, a couple months ago. This is the most recent talk, actually, that we had with him. He started talking about, that he said that he survives on blood, okay? I'm trying to remember how the subject came up, but what he said was that he and the other beings in the underworld, they actually do drink blood, and that he said God brings it to them. He also referred to it as gum, G-U-M. And I looked up gum, and sure enough, this is a word that goes back to ancient Sumer. It's been around forever. And I think what it really means in this reference here is it's talking about the soul material that is supposedly in blood. You've heard that, it says in the Bible, the blood is the life. And in fact, the Bible says that we humans are not supposed to drink blood because it has the life inside of it. But and then there's places in the Bible where it also indicates that actually it's drinking blood that will prolong your life, because you're drinking this soul material. So I don't know if you remember, like, when the flood happened, and Noah makes the sacrifice right after the floodwaters start to subside, he's thankful to God, so he makes a sacrifice, and God promises not to flood the earth again, and he also passes down all of these rules. It was the first time God had ever given anyone a list of rules, really, and he said that one of the things on the list is don't consume blood. So we know that people aren't supposed to consume blood, but of course, as part of the sacrifices to God in the Old Testament, they were pouring blood all over the altar.
Right.
And the implication is basically the blood is for God, not for humans. He doesn't want us to have it because, as it says in the Garden of Eden story in Genesis, right after we humans gained the fruit of the tree of knowledge, of course, we were kicked out of the garden, and one of the last things that's said right there before the garden is sealed off by the flaming sword of the angels is that God is afraid that we humans are going to stretch our hands forth and take of the tree of life,
right.
The fruit of the tree of life.
Right.
What that is, as far as I can tell from talking to Cain, we're talking about blood and the soul material within it.
Where does he get his blood from?
He said that God delivers it to him. To keep him alive, just barely alive, the semblance of life that he has comes from that. And this matches up, strangely enough, with something that Plutarch wrote about Saturn. He told a story about how, you know, the Titans, the Greek gods, the Titans, were, of course, taken over by the Olympian gods. And Zeus imprisoned Saturn, or Kronos, on an island, it says, and chained him. And it says he's chained by his dreams. He's in a death-like sleep dreaming, and his dreams actually keep him chained there. And he's kept alive by birds that come and feed him ambrosia, which is the food of the gods in the Greek stories. And it says that Zeus is the one that sends these birds to feed Saturn Kronos this ambrosia. And when I was talking to Cain, we asked him about this blood. At first we asked, who brings it to you? And he said, birds. And then we said, who sends the birds? And he said, God. And this message came before I really understood the connection with the Saturn story. So when I did that research and connected it up, it all made sense all of a sudden. And that's when I realized that the ambrosia that they're talking about is blood, or the soul material that is derived from the blood. And when you look at all these myths and stories about the water of life, or the fruit of life, or this substance that brings immortality to people, and that the gods themselves have to consume in order to maintain their immortality, I think they're talking about blood.
With all of your experiences now over the last 12, 13, 14 years with Cain and with Baphomet, do you fear death?
Sorry. Do you mean, am I afraid of what will happen after I die?
Yeah. Yeah.
Found out about what it's like?
Well, you know, that's the oldest question. There's two old questions. One, are we alone in the universe? And number two, what happens when we die? Do you care now?
Oh, yeah. I mean, look, of course I'm concerned about my own soul, and I would, of course, prefer to go to heaven than hell. But even more than that, the whole thing is just scary, because basically I'm being presented a story about these beings on the other side, God, angels, demons, all of these guys. They seem very predatory on humans and very anti-human. And even though, you know, we're told that God loves us, and especially, you know, Jesus loves us and is going to intercede for us to try to save us, it's still scary to realize that they would even think of throwing us into hell, that they would feed off of our blood, that God is, you know, rigging the situation so that we can't achieve long life.
Right, of course.
You know, I mean, there's so many negative things, actually, about negative things that God has done to humans, that it's really scary. And also then, of course, you know, people think, oh, well, then turn to the devil, because he's really the, you know, Lucifer, the light bringer, and he wants you to have wisdom and stuff. Well, you know, I've found that certainly you can get information from him and people on his side, but at the same time, you know, I don't think they're your friends at all. I mean, they also are very anti-human, probably more so than God, I suppose.
Where is Cain now? Is he in heaven? Is he in hell? Or is he purgatory bound? Where does he hang out?
He's in the underworld. And the last time we spoke to him, we asked about this rumor that's going around now, that the gates of hell have been opened. You know, about the message that came through on the iPhone, the Siri app that happened a few months ago.
Right.
Where it just, there was this glitch, and all of a sudden, you know, you asked the app about this one date in July, and it would tell you that this is the day that the gates of Hades open.
I saw it myself. I saw it and did it myself with a friend. I was like, you got to be kidding me. It's I don't know if it's a glitch, but the message was there. Yeah, I don't know if that's a glitch.
And so there were other things going on in the headlines at the time where I really thought, that the behavior of ISIS, for instance, in Iraq, indicated that those people might be demonically possessed. And there were some other things going on in the headlines that made me think, you know what, maybe this isn't a joke. And since I can talk to Cain or Baphomet anytime I want to, I might as well ask them. And so we asked Cain is it true that the gates of hell have opened? And he said, yes. And then we said, when? And he said, 17 days ago. And
well, how close was that to the Siri date?
Very close, within like 4 or 5 days.
No.
But it wasn't on the dot, but it was very close.
Really? Have you asked him? That's interesting about Iraq and Syria, of course, with, you know, biblical history and so forth. Have you asked Cain about ISIS?
Yes.
You have? Okay. Okay.
Yes, we brought that up. I mean, I was hoping to get more details about what was going on in Iraq and maybe what's the real motivation, you know, from the powers that be about allowing that to happen or maybe fomenting it and causing it to happen. And see, the last session we had with him, he got a little bit crazy. I mean, it was a different Cain in a way, in that he was really excited about talking about the gates of hell opening. He said he's still down there. He's still in the underworld himself because he has a job to do down there still, but eventually he'll be let out along with all the others. He said very soon. And that's why he was getting so excited. And so when we asked about Iraq, I think that might have been when the Amalek thing came out. And he starts getting excited about drinking blood. And one of the messages he spelled out is, Amaleks get to rape and rape and rape and rape and rape. And it went on and on until we interrupted it. He just kept saying rape. So, you know, it was, I say it's a different Cain because previously we were talking about very academic subjects, just having a very intellectual discussion. But this time he was really losing his cool because he was getting so excited about being out of hell soon and being able to drink blood and rape when he came to the surface. And it seemed like that concept was connected, that he started talking about that really when we asked about Iraq. So we were trying to ask what's the strategic reason for doing this, and he just wanted to talk about raping and drinking blood. And so, again, I'm thinking, that's really what's going on there in Iraq. It's not even that it's a geopolitical strategy necessarily, although it might still be, but part of the story is just that these people have been possessed by demons. Those demons are so happy to be out of hell, and they're going around cutting off heads and raping and maybe drinking blood. I don't know, but that's kind of what I thought was the upshot of his message.
Did he make a comment about the name ISIS too as well? Because that's always seemed strange to me.
You know, I don't think we didn't get an answer about that.
Okay. But you asked, did you ask? I mean, it's just such a strange name for a terrorist organization that seems to be running rampant over two of the most oldest cultures in the known universe. And it's called ISIS. You know, I just find that very strange.
Well, no doubt. I mean, she's the bride of the god of the underworld in Egyptian pantheon there. So, and if you think about it, even the image of the sleeping Osiris in the underworld, the actual depiction of him, I'll send you a picture of this to show you what I mean after the show. There's a picture of Osiris in the underworld that's really amazing. It shows him underneath this mountain that exists only in the underworld. He's in a tomb there, just laying asleep, because that's the way Osiris is described in the underworld. It's the same as Cain being in a death-like sleep. He's neither alive nor dead. And then you can see in this image a little sun symbol floating right above him. So, again, like as though his tomb is lit by the inner sun of the underworld, just like Cain. So I don't know. Maybe they are the same figure. I haven't asked him yet, but, you know, that could be. That could be part of the story there.
With Cain, does anybody else communicate with him, you know, through Ouija around the world, and have they contacted you?
No one's contacted me talking about Cain, talking to Cain yet, although there may be other people talking to him. I'm not sure. But I have recently, just since this book came out, gotten messages from people who say they were inspired by me to go ahead and try the Ouija board. And with some of them, they're actually contacting the same spirits. I'm talking about Baphomet and also Berenger Saunier, who's a character in the Priory of Zion Grail story. And the messages that they're getting is, it's like the same conversation. It's like they're continuing the conversation. So I feel like some of these people not only have been inspired by me, but now they're tapping into the same ethos that I was. And I have no idea what's going to come of that, because it's starting to freak me out a little bit. I mean, I had control over this thing before, you know, it was my little secret.
Right.
And now it's out and other people are playing with the same fire that I was playing with. And I don't know what's going to come of it.
Well, that's exactly why I'm asking. You know, there was some form of exclusivity there. You know, you're right. Now the book is out and now people know that it's possible. And, mm-hmm. you know, I don't know, are they getting busy signals? Can he only talk to one at a time? You know what I mean?
I understand what your question is. And I think that actually they don't get busy signals. I think Baphomet, for instance, is talking to all sorts of people at the same time he's talking to me, you know, because he has, he's like the patron deity of, you know, Freemasons and the OTO, the Rosicrucians. He's busy, I think. So, you know, when he's talking to me, he's probably carrying on several conversations at once, which you would expect from him. I mean, he's got, you know, breaths and a go-ahead and one arm pointing up and one arm pointing down. So you would think this is a guy who knows how to multitask. You know?
Right, right.
It's probably not a problem for him.
That's a good way to put it. Have you ever, we're at the top of the hour, you know, I haven't even done a station break or anything. Fascinating conversation. This is Fade to Black on the Dark Matter Radio Network. We're talking to Tracy Twyman, day 3 of Halloween week here on the Dark Matter Radio Network. And you can follow us on Twitter at JChurchRadio. Shoot me an email to jimmy@jimmychurchradio.com. I haven't even checked email tonight. Fascinating conversation, Tracy. Thank you so much for this.
Sure.
Now, let's just switch gears. We could talk Cain all night, and I'm thinking I'm going to steal you from Clyde. So Clyde, consider it theft. I'm sorry, my brother. I got to get you on the show again. I've left way too much on the table. So let's switch gears. And also, as we do, let's move over to, Baphomet. And
sure.
But before we do that, you designed, and I found this fascinating, you had to figure out an easier way to communicate with Baphomet and Cain, and you ended up designing your own Ouija board. So you don't use a traditional Ouija board. So how did you change it, and describe that for us?
Okay, yeah. Well, actually, it was my husband, Brian, and he was inspired to do it. By Baphomet, we assume. I mean, he was inspired. You can tell when you're under the inspiration from spirits. I don't know how to describe it to you, but it's just you get ideas that you wouldn't otherwise get. And, you know, this came after several sessions with Baphomet where he was obsessed with spelling out the alphabet over and over again. He would go from A to Z and D to Y and basically invert the alphabet from the ends inward. You know, he kept doing that letter sequence over and over again. And we were asking him what it meant. We had all sorts of interpretation about what we thought it meant. But so eventually my husband just woke up in the middle of the night, I guess around 2 or 3 a.m., and just started designing something on Photoshop. I woke up the next morning and I saw it on his computer screen. I'm like, what's that? And he said, I just was inspired to do this. And the letters were all arranged according to that method that, you know, A was on the opposite side of the wheel from Z, but it was like you could imagine the alphabet being broken in half and then half of it flipped. So we have the alphabet arranged like that in a circle. And there's a 13-sided star in the middle of that circle because the number 13 was emphasized to us over and over again, the importance of that. And then we had, there's a zodiac around it, but it's a 13-house zodiac with the extra house, which is called a fucus, the serpent holder. We included that. And then the sun, we have the sun and the moon like on the traditional Ouija board, but the sun is black. And then on either sides, we have the pillars of Yakin and Boaz, like you would find at a Masonic temple or on a Masonic tracing board, which it took me years, 13 years to realize this. But now when I look at this Ouija board that Brian Albert designed, my husband, I realize that it really very much resembles a Masonic tracing board. And you'll see this when you look at the image. It's in the book. It's also, I don't know if it's on my website. Maybe I should put it there. So and maybe I'll just put a post and show you the Ouija board and then the Masonic tracing boards, because it's really remarkably similar. But I don't think Brian realized that at the time. Oh, and then at the bottom of it, we've got waves of water. And that was, Brian said he was inspired to put the abyss down there, the watery abyss of chaos. So it's basically, this is the idea, I think this is the way even the Jewish Kabbalists sort of described the structure of the universe, the way it's all ordered, is like, there's the underworld beneath us, and there's a cover, basically, that separates us from that. And that is described as being this abyss of chaos. So at the bottom of your traditional Ouija board, you would have the word goodbye. But with ours, every time they want to, the spirits want to, say goodbye, or if they want to, also sometimes they use it to just sort of trash your question, like, ask me another question, I don't want to hear about that. They'll go down to the abyss at the bottom. And so those are the main things that are different on this Ouija board. It's a very unique design. You'll never see anything like it.
Is it easier on the planchette? Is it easier to, move around and spell and get the communication out?
I think so. We certainly found it so. And if you go to my website, TracyTwyman.com, there'll be a link to the YouTube channel. There's also a post on there about videos of the Ouija sessions. So if you go look at those videos, you'll see how quickly and in some instances it was moving around so fast you couldn't possibly, remember all the letters that were being spelled out.
I frequently
would get lost in the message, and the whole thing started to pick up once we put it in that circle and the letters in that sequence. The interesting thing that we found out later, after the board had been designed, is that this sequence of A equals Z, B equals Y, inverting the alphabet like that, is called the Atbash cipher. And it turns out that it has been associated with the Knights Templar. And in fact, when you run the word Baphomet through the Atbash cipher in Aramaic, which is the language that Jesus would have spoken, then you get the word Sophia, which means wisdom, the wisdom of God. So it has been theorized in the past that that's really what Baphomet was. It was just a code word for divine wisdom. And interestingly, the place where Baphomet told us the skull was, because he said that, yes, he is, his home basically is a skull, or he is somehow connected to this skull that the Templars used in their rituals. And he said it was John the Baptist's skull. And he said it's in Istanbul. And again, it took me a while to research it, but sure enough, there's the Church of Sophia, the Divine Wisdom, in Istanbul, and it has John the Baptist's skull right in it. So he told the truth.
That's interesting. And it's a beautiful church, by the way. Now, Baphomet. Wow, I'm just tripping out right now, Trace. I'm just tripping out. Let's go to Baphomet. How did that first conversation happen? Did he come to you?
Cain told us about him because
by name.
Yes. Okay. Here's how it started. And you can actually see the video where we were first told about Baphomet on the YouTube channel.
What's the video? What's the video called? It's going to get
called
tweeted.
I'm sorry.
It's going to get tweeted. It's going to get tweeted to half the world right now. Okay. Go ahead.
It's called Acknowledge Baphomet.
Acknowledge Baphomet. I want to see that link up in Twitter in 9 seconds. 8, 7, 6. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, yes. During this session, we were talking to Cain and asking actually some personal questions. Because we were getting the idea that, we were being led to do certain things we were trying to figure out, for one thing, who's inspiring all of these inspirations that we're feeling, you know, in regards to the research we were doing, the writing I was doing. And then also, it felt like we were cursed, actually. Brian and I noticed that we were having all sorts of problems with money. It just seemed like we couldn't get ahead. It was almost stopping me from doing the work that I was trying to do. And so we just decided to ask, you know, since he's a spirit in the underworld, he has a vision that we don't have. Are we cursed? Is there something on us that's oppressing us and preventing us from being able to succeed, especially with money? And he says, yes, in fact, that it's Baphomet who has cursed us. And that's when we first heard the word. I hadn't really thought about Baphomet in a long time. I had written an article about it, but just, I was just writing about Templars and their idol that they worshipped. I really didn't think about the concept of Baphomet beyond that. But here, Cain was telling us that Baphomet had cursed us. And the reason why that happened, he said, was because I had a friend whose name was he called himself Prince Nicholas de Vere von Drakenberg. He had written a book about this Grail bloodline. He said he was a member of it, that he was actually the rightful king of the world, is how, I guess, he would describe it. And he said that this was because of his bloodline, and he traced his genealogy all the way back to these ancient gods and the Nephilim, you know. And so he wrote this book about the subject. He even had a secret society called the Dragon Court that was dedicated to this subject. And I was friends with the guy. I thought his book was very interesting, and I had promised to help him publish it. But then I just got, you know, busy with other stuff, and I wasn't thinking about it. And then here comes this message from Cain telling us Baphomet has cursed us, and it's because I didn't publish Nicholas de Vere's book yet.
What?
And so,
what?
Yes.
Really?
And so we ask, why does Baphomet care about Nicholas de Vere's book?
Well, and what kind of curse was it? Did that ever come about?
Yeah, it's the curse. He referred to the curse by name as money. See, we've talked about curses many times, and every time a curse will basically just have a name that describes what it is, you know. So our curse was money, that we couldn't get money. And this was because, he said, I had failed to acknowledge Baphomet. And so I asked, how do you do that? And he said, publish a book. And then we asked, which book? Because I was working on two books at that time.
Right.
And that's when he said Nicholas de Vere's book. And I'm like, what? What about my book? But he didn't care about my book. He wanted me to publish this other book. And we asked, why do you care? Why does Baphomet care about Nick's book? And then the answer came, because she is related. She is Baphomet, because Baphomet is hermaphroditic.
Both, and right? Baphomet is both sides of the coin, right?
Right. Baphomet is both male and female. Right. And that's how he or she is most commonly depicted these days. And yes, basically, Cain was telling us that Baphomet is one of Nicholas de Vere's ancestors. And that's why he or she cares about Nicholas de Vere's career.
You've got to be kidding me. For real.
I am not. And so that's how I ended up. I took that project seriously all of a sudden. I'm
yes,
like, okay, well,
did.
I don't want to be cursed, so I better do this. And I did. I helped the guy publish his book and helped him do some PR for several years.
Yes, you did. Did you design the cover and do the editing and proofreading as well?
Well, my husband designed the cover. Brian
exactly.
Albert designed the cover.
Exactly. Don't want that curse of Baphomet coming down. That is interesting. And obviously, yes. You didn't speak to Cain about this because you didn't really know about it. And you were
right.
Working on, wow, that's very interesting. Okay, so Baphomet now is part of your life.
Right.
What was the first conversation? Did he come to you, or did you, I don't want to say summon, but I don't know. You don't place a phone call. You're sitting at the Ouija board. So how did that happen that first day?
Yeah, it was just like all the others. I said, okay, Baphomet, are you there? And he started talking. And we did notice a difference in sort of the voice of the spirit right away. You know, I described Cain as being kind of asleep, I guess, you know, foggy headed, but even though he was much more clear and much more understandable than Cocteau, but Cain was nothing compared to Baphomet. Baphomet is awake. Baphomet is not a sleeping entity in the underworld. He's very much awake and active. And so one of the interesting things that came out when we started talking to both Cain and Baphomet alternately at different times on the new design of the Ouija board is that since we had all the letters arranged in a circle and also in that weird at-bash cipher, there's a noticeable pattern that would come through. Cain would always go in circles, and Baphomet would frequently sort of jerk from side to side to get from one letter to another. And so it seemed like Cain was almost expressing himself because he's a solar entity, the black sun. It seemed like maybe that's why he's expressing himself in circles, whereas Baphomet is this being that embodies opposites. You know, he's male and female. He's pointing to the ground and up to the heavens. He's light and darkness at the same time. That's what he is the embodiment of the union of opposites, and that's why he's associated with alchemy. And so this was all expressed in the way that he spoke, and that's even expressed in the way that he would identify himself with the at-bash cipher.
And you keep saying...
It's all about jerking from side to side, going from one side to another.
You keep saying him. So how do you refer to Baphomet? It sounds like a male name, first off. I understand that. But you keep saying him. Do you refer to Baphomet as him? Or is it more like...
I do.
It, if you know what I mean. I
Yeah, it's just like people refer to God as him. I'm just saying him just for ease of speaking. But they, the spirits, seem to frequently refer to it as she. So, you know, I guess maybe I should be saying she, but no one's ever complained. They have never said, hey, I'm a she, not a he. So I just keep saying he. Just as it's
fair enough, fair enough.
For me, I think.
Fair enough. Okay. All right. So is Baphomet evil? And what I mean by that is, obviously, you've got the horns, you've got the skull, you've got the inverted pentagram, you've got Aleister Crowley, who, you know, we don't need to talk about. There is that image, and certainly it's a scary one. I mean, you look, it's not a friendly image. It's not Pokemon. You know, it's a very dark image. Is Baphomet evil?
You know, I think so, and it took a while for me to really come to that conclusion. Again, mainly because we were just getting into really esoteric concepts, and, you know, I wasn't judging him based on, you know, value judgments at the time. I was just trying to get information. And certainly, from a Christian perspective, he started saying things that I'm sure, you know, Christians would not like. You know, when we asked about the crucifixion, he told us that Judas was the one who died on the cross and not Jesus, and that Jesus had allowed that to happen. So, you know, he was always telling us these sort of heretical versions of Bible stories. But when he really presented himself as evil, came a little bit later when we asked him about, the conversation started off asking about the war in heaven and the fall from Eden, and how the conflict between God and the devil started. You know, what was it all about? And that's when he really started open up, I guess, seemingly identifying himself with the devil. He called himself the beast of the apocalypse. He said that he hated humans, that the whole conflict started because of what he said was the love of man, that God loved man and wanted him to love man, but he didn't love man. He was disgusted, and so he refused to bow down to man when God asked him to, which, as it turns out, is a story in the Quran, and also earlier it was in this book called The Book of Adam and Eve, which was a Christian scripture. So he referred to this old story about, you know, the real conflict between God and the devil is about man and whether, and you know, wanting the devil who was at that time just an angel, to show allegiance to mankind. And there was a disgust, basically, from him for that. You know, for one thing, there's the idea that you're only supposed to bow down to God. And here God himself was asking, the figure that became Satan, essentially, and Baphomet, the same thing, really, to bow down to man. He was disgusted by that. He said, they are made of clay, and I'm something more than that. So that's where the whole conflict started, he said. And we start asking more questions.
Well, that's really interesting. And at that point, did you feel like he was talking down to you? Did he say that he hated you?
No, because we asked about that in a way. Here's how the conversation went. We asked, he was describing all of these events and what we thought was the war in heaven and maybe the conflict in the Garden of Eden.
Right.
And something about the way he phrased it confused me. And I said, it sounds like you're talking about something in the future, but aren't you talking about the past and the war in heaven, all this stuff in the beginning? And he said, yes, now, really soon. And so he was saying, like, that it's both in the future and in the past. And so that's when I got really confused. Well, how can that be? And that's when he said, this is even on the back of the book. He starts talking, he admits basically that he's essentially talking about the war between them, between God and the devil, as a continuous thing. And that from his point of view, it's neither in the past nor the future. It's happening now. And he said that that it was, the apocalypse was coming. He was excited about that. He was part of it. He was the beast of the apocalypse. We asked him what's going to happen, and he said, after the war, people die and man jailed in the abyss. And so we said, why will man be jailed in the abyss? And he said, sin. And after some questioning, he admitted that, yes, he is actually trying to lead man to sin. And we asked, why are you doing that? He said, to defy God. And, you know, he described how, he said, he and God planned the apocalypse together. He said they're basically playing a game with each other. And that he thinks they're going to be reconciled at the end. Basically, he's going to prove himself to God somehow. And then God will accept him again, and instead of him going into the lake of fire, the way it says in Revelation. So that's what he was planning. And, we asked, who's the war between? He said, man and God. So, like, we're stuck in the middle. We're the pawns on the chessboard.
Exactly. Exactly. Well, he's not mincing words there. That's exactly what he's saying. What about organized religion? And I'm talking about including, you know, Islam, Catholicism, the Vatican, Christianity. Are they aware of this as well? Do they know about this game that is going on, this continuous game between, the left and the right and man being in the middle?
Well, maybe some of them are. I mean, I don't know exactly what goes on in the upper echelons of these groups, but actually some of the things that were said to us by both Cain and Baphomet when we asked about, I don't know, a variety of things that they told us indicated that there are priests, for instance, Catholic priests, who in their prayer end up talking to Baphomet. Whether they're doing that intentionally or not, I'm not sure. But that we were given the implication, basically, that Baphomet is communicating with and utilizing several Catholic priests. Excuse me. So I do think that it's possible. I mean, I really think of the leadership of certainly the Catholic Church and probably several other churches as well. I really think it's being run by people who are very esoteric minded. They communicate with God and angels and, who knows what else on their own in secret. And we'll never know, what is said, but I wouldn't doubt if the Pope knows this stuff and
Well, it's
you know, yeah, some of the others.
It makes you wonder why, what happened with Baphomet to make him so pissed off. And before you answer that, Cortana just tweeted, sounds like Baphomet's got some daddy issues. If you know, and
that's exactly it.
Yes, that's exactly it. What did he say? And who was who was his dad? I mean, when he was, obviously he was human at one time, right?
No. Humans came afterward, and that was the problem. The angels existed, right? And of course, I'm not really sure about that there is even such a thing as chronology when we're talking about the beginning and the end. I think that time means something different in those contexts, but certainly the way the stories are told in the scriptures, and also what he seemed to be indicating, is that yes, there were angels and there was God, and then God created man, created Adam, and he was so proud of Adam because of his beauty and his wisdom. And in particular, Adam, there's this, again, Jewish Kabbalistic story about this. Adam was able to name all of the animals. He just instinctively knew what they should be called, as God would bring them up out of nothingness, out of the ether, and all these life forms would appear in front of Adam, and Adam just would spontaneously say, hey, that's a bird, that's a elephant, I don't know, you know, all these, he just instinctively knew what they should be called. And that's why Adam was remembered as the inventor, really, or the father of the original 70 languages. There's this stuff in the Kabbalah that talks about this. And so it seems to me like, excuse me, that's why Baphomet is angry. That's why the devil is angry, is because they were jealous of this, you know, ostentatious display of Adam's abilities with language, and God telling them, okay, look at my creation. He's so wonderful. Please bow down to him. You know, it was enough to make them mad. And yeah, these things seem so petty to us, but from their point of view, you know, since time isn't the same for them, it's nothing really to, you know, kill millions of people and spend thousands of years on a grudge because they've got nothing but time where they are, and they ended up in the abyss. See, that's the thing. Yes, they started having this war. The end result is that they got trapped in the underworld by God. They are in jail. And they can't enjoy being alive the way they used to. They're jealous of us because here we are in the plane of life. We're enjoying food and sex and all these things that they can't have.
Right.
And that's why they want to possess us. That's why they desperately want magicians to do rituals to break them out of the abyss. And that's what they anticipate happening at the end. In the apocalypse, is they'll be let out, you know, and the Bible talks about how they're so excited when they get out because they know they only have a short time. So they start, you know, raping and pillaging like mad because this is their first chance to be out of jail after all those years.
And so, did Baphomet ever tell you why they can't figure out a way to get around what God has done? Obviously, they're still down below. They haven't figured it out yet. They're trying. Supposedly, the gates of hell have been opened, according to Siri. You know what I mean? It's like God has got the perfect code, the perfect. You know what I mean? They're trapped. They can't figure out a way out. It reminds me of the movie Dogma, actually.
Yes. Well, it is. It is like that. And yes, one of the things that happened with the most recent Cain seance, actually, I think maybe shed some light on that. And it also was the first time for me that I ever got the idea of what might actually be dangerous about a Ouija board, because I've just been so annoyed with people telling me how dangerous it is. And you know, to me, it's just like letters and numbers on it, written on a piece of paper. What's the big deal, you know? And why is it okay to do a tarot, say, a reading or something, but not this? To me, it seems stupid. But anyway, we were using the board, and we noticed that Cain starts just compulsively going to the edges of the board and going around in the circle of the letters in a very methodical way. And all of a sudden I realized that when he's going around in a circle, he's circumambulating like you would at the beginning of a ritual. You and the participants will all go around in a circle to kind of stir up the energies and open the portal to the other side during a ritual. They do this at the beginning of even Masonic rituals. And they even do it at, you know, on, what is it, Ramadan or at the Hajj, you know, the Muslims will do this right around the Kaaba.
Right.
They circumambulate. And the other thing you do when you're opening a lodge for a ritual is you call the points. You basically call up the spirits and then open up the gates of the four points on the compass. And I realized that that's what he was doing on the board. He was using the board as though it was a Masonic lodge. And remember I mentioned that the board that we invented looks like a Masonic tracing board, so it resembles a Masonic lodge in a way.
Mm-hmm.
And he was doing a little ritual on the board to try to open a portal. And we asked him, is that what you're doing? You're trying to open a portal to come here? And he said, yes.
Have you ever talked to Freeman about that?
I don't know. I don't remember what we talked about.
I'm just saying he would be the authority to say yes or no on that. When it comes to Masonic rituals and what actually goes down. I'm just asking if you've ever talked to Freeman about it. I'm certainly calling Freeman tomorrow.
Okay.
I'm gonna get to the bottom line on that. I just got an email really quick. I just want to run this by you. We were talking about this earlier. The original language, the language of light, is tongues. This comes from Demian, and he says, which we forget when we enter the third dimension or sin, that of which is time. We speak it on occasion when we truly feel God, but it is spoke from our spirit, not body. It was a metaphorical language before the Tower of Babel, which is universal spiritual unity that materialism confounds. I thought that was interesting. I'll actually forward this email to you. I thought that was pretty interesting. Okay.
Well, it's interesting because he said it was a metaphorical language, and actually right before Baphomet told us that he was speaking the language of light, see, what it was, I remember he spelled out a word, Nazgiromar, like Nazgiromar, Nazgiromar. And so I asked, what is that? And he said it was a metaphor for man before me, like when he was talking about being forced to bow down to man. And we said, well, language, and he said language of light. So again, yeah, maybe it is actually a metaphorical language. To me, that makes sense because I've always been amazed at how metaphorically minded, symbolically minded the ancients were, ancient man and the myths. They're so multi-layered. You would think, you know, how do these old people, the ancient people who, you know, probably didn't live very long and were struggling to survive, how did they get such a high mindset that they have all of these really deep metaphors that they use for everything? Yeah. Well, maybe they were just in touch with the other side, and the other side prefers to speak in metaphor. I mean, the spirits that I've talked to, one of the things I've noticed is that they're very poetic, and they do use lots of metaphors, symbols, multi-layers of symbols, and you have to really be able to work with that. You have to know a lot of symbolism already in order to be able to follow what they're saying. So to me, it makes sense, actually, to think of the language of light, which is the language that the angels speak, as being metaphorical in a way. It is symbolic, I think, perhaps, in that it's when we hear it or we read it, we perceive it as basically symbolic.
So I'm going to open up the phone lines. Let's take a couple of phone calls before we start to wind this down. 323-825-5045. Phone lines are open. Let me click a couple of buttons here, and I'll get them going. All right, hold on. Let me scroll. I can't speak and chew gum, Tracy, obviously. Okay, we're good to go. 323-825-5045. You can also Skype in Fade2Black14 if you would like to ask Tracy a quick question. Let's get a... Okay, well, that didn't take long. Okay. I thought we were on a 10-second delay. How you doing tonight, Ken? Say hi to Tracy.
Jimmy, how you doing tonight? Hey, Tracy, how you doing? I'm a big fan of yours. I read your book, The Money Grows on the Tree of Knowledge. I could listen to you every night.
Hello?
There he is. I got him up, Tracy.
Did you hear anything I said?
Yeah. Go ahead, Ken. We got you.
Okay, so Tracy, I'm a big fan. I just want to ask you one question. I got like a billion, but I just want to ask you this one. In all of your research and your contact in the spirits and all that stuff, has Cthulhu or Janus ever come up?
Cthulhu or Canaan?
Janus.
Yep.
Janus. Cthulhu, we haven't talked about. No, I don't think we've ever talked about Janus, per se.
Okay, there you go. One more quick question, Ken. I've got calls backed up. One more.
Oh, okay. That was my thought. That was going to be a big answer, but okay, I don't know. I don't really have anything else, Tracy. I had a bunch of questions, but I was really focused on that. Well, let me ask this. As far as like you really, the way that you're describing it, you're really believing that what was written in like the Old Testament, the New Testament, the Quran, and all that stuff had some elements of truth. Do you think these were actually like biographical stories, or were they just like things that people saw? Like you said, they were communicating with spirits and they were made up, or is it more of like a literal sense?
Yeah.
Thank you so much for taking my call.
Yeah, you got it. Thank you, Ken. You have a good night.
You too.
Well, I would say that this experience of talking to the spirits has given me a different perspective on those things where, for one thing, I can tell that these scriptures, like say, for instance, the ones in the Bible and the Quran for sure, now that I know what it's like to channel and be inspired, I can tell that that is what has happened with these scriptures. So I used to really be obsessed with the idea of trying to figure out what had been edited and what's been changed with the stories over time and what was the motivation for that. But now I'm really thinking that it is inspired. Now, it doesn't mean it's necessarily true, but I know when I read the Bible, I can tell these scriptures have been inspired by something. And then the other thing I would say is that I really feel, especially with a lot of these old stories in the Old Testament, like the stuff that's in Genesis, which is, I would say, all the stuff from the Garden of Eden up through the story of Abraham, for sure, and maybe further to the 12 tribes of Israel. I feel like all of that could quite possibly be descriptions of things that happened basically in another dimension or on the other side. And just to give you an example, I think that perhaps the story of Moses going across the Red Sea and to get to the Holy Land and the wandering for 40 years before they got there, I really think that that's about a portal opening and going into the underworld and getting lost for a little while in the chaos and the basically nothingness that's down there. So, I start to look at all these stories a little bit differently. One of the things, for instance, that Cain told us is that the 12 tribes of Israel really represent the 12 races of Atlantis, he said, that there were these 12 races that used to exist before the flood. And he said only three of them exist now because the rest died in the flood. And so he said, each one just corresponds to a tribe of Israel, that that's really just a metaphor for that. And so the ones he said that are still alive are the fairy race, the giants, and the underground race.
Interesting.
So, yeah.
Interesting. Let's take another call. Hi, you're live on Fade to Black. Who's calling? Where are you calling from? Say hi to Tracy.
Hey, Tracy. This is Star 6. I, boy, I got my head spinning around like the Exorcist. I have one, a series of questions, actually, and I just want to be as brief as I can. I am. How do you feel about Powell's work in terms of, hang on, I forget the term. Familiar spirits. Have you ever ran into that, a familiar spirit?
What do I think about the term familiar spirit?
Yeah, no, I mean, have you actually had a definition from the other side defining the familiar spirit? As Reverend Powell describes in his works.
Okay, well, I guess I haven't actually asked them a question about that. I mean, I get the idea that, you know, witches would have a... Go ahead.
Just a quickie. It just means there's a spirit on the other side that knows you perfectly,
mm-hmm.
and that's why they dominates you from the soul level in this third dimension. And you can kind of compare it to the previous guest, it's the same thing where you're being possessed by a negative force, whether it comes through a Ouija board or not, it doesn't really matter. A negative force is a negative force, and that's what hell on earth is about. And yes, you can go 17 backs, and most people will agree with you that this is the end result of us, meaning worldwide, not doing what is correct. And so hell is being leashed, and it can be controlled if everybody practices the law one, as far as I'm concerned. I don't know. Do you have any? And by the way, the large skulls, where do you find the largest source of those? I find them to be in Peru.
Okay.
I'm sorry?
One question at a time. Hey, thank you, Star Six. I'll.
Hey, you're welcome. You know you got the greatest show on earth. Bye-bye.
Thanks, Star Six. I guess what I was actually going to ask you, hang on, caller. I'm going to put you on hold. Just stay with us. I was going to ask you this earlier. Have you ever felt that maybe Baphomet or maybe Cain were controlling you? Did you ever feel controlled?
Yes, especially Baphomet. I mean, basically, I got the idea from what Cain said to me, that Baphomet was the one inspiring me from the very beginning, from age 18, to start Dagobert's Revenge, which makes sense because Dagobert's Revenge was all about Western occultism, which really comes from the Templars and Freemasons. I mean, I think that Baphomet is the patron of pretty much all Western occultism. And so I do feel like that's what I tapped into mentally as soon as I started studying the subject when I was a teenager. And when I got these inspired ideas to start that magazine, and then a lot of the research that I did after that was very inspired, I feel like it was probably Baphomet inspiring me. And then the whole reason why there was a period in my life when I wasn't doing these seances anymore, I had rejected the whole thing, and I shut down the secret society that we had, which was called Ordo Laps et Exilis, which was attached to this. It was attached to our magazine and the research I was doing, and basically Baphomet was like what they call in the occult outer head. He was like the spiritual patron of our order. And basically what happened over time is I just kind of got sick of having all these projects that it seemed like he kept driving me to do. And, you know, I mentioned that it seemed like we were cursed with monetary problems. Well, yeah, I made money, but it was never enough to finance all the things that he was constantly pushing me to do. And then we would literally get advice about how to raise funds for the projects he wanted us to do. And, you know, so we tried some of those, but it just seemed like, man, this is a lot of work and I'm not benefiting from it very much. And eventually I just thought, you know what, this isn't the relationship that you're supposed to have with spirits, because even magicians will tell you that you're supposed to actually control them. It's supposed to be the other way around.
Right.
And,
right,
you know,
right.
I started looking into it and I realized, oh, I've made a big mistake by letting them push me around. And if I'm going to communicate with them at all, I certainly shouldn't let them control me. And if anything, if you really want to be a master, you have to figure out how to control them, which I would say I haven't done. It's a little bit, again, it's like I don't want to give myself a whole bunch of work, and having to learn how to control a spirit just seems like a whole bunch of work. So at this point, it's just sort of a, you know, friendly relationship maybe, you know, in that I can talk to them, I can get useful responses. But I don't allow them to tell me what to do anymore. I don't take any
that was my question.
Career advice or inspiration.
Right. I swear that was my question. Have you ever went back to Baphomet and go, okay, dude, check this out? It's you know, you need to stop what you're doing. You know, you can hang out with me here, but you're not going to manipulate me. Have you gone there with them directly?
Yeah, pretty much. Yep. Yeah, we have had that. You know, I have said that. And wow. It doesn't seem to have been contested at all. In fact, the whole thing did. The pressure is off me, I would say. The whole thing did die down after I made that decision.
And you could feel it? Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, interesting. Hi, you're live on Fade to Black with Tracy Twyman. Say hi to Tracy. Who's calling?
This is Rob from Pahrump, Nevada.
Hey, Rob from Pahrump, Nevada, out there in Art Bell country. How you doing tonight, Rob?
Pretty good. Listen, my question is, how do you feel about the Talmud of Jamal? Of Emmanuel, I'm sorry. Talmud of Emmanuel?
Tracy?
I could barely understand that. Could you tell me what he said?
He's go ahead. Say it again.
The Talmud of Emmanuel, the true
the Talmud
Bible
of
written
Emmanuel.
By
yes.
Iscariot. Jesus did not die on the cross, and Judas did not turn him in. It was Judah Iscariot, not Judas Iscariot. Judas actually went to India, took Jesus off the cross. He did not die, and took him to India, where he lived
to
be 110 years old.
That's very interesting. I'm writing it down. I'm going to look it up. I mean, I knew that story, like I said, was in the Quran and the Book of Adam and Eve, but if there's another source of that, I'll definitely check it out.
It's the Talmud of Emmanuel.
Right?
Yep.
Emmanuel spelled J-M-M-A-N-U-E-L. Talmud. T-A-L-M-U-D.
Yeah, okay, okay. Go ahead, Tracy.
No, I mean, I'm not familiar with that work, so I'm going to have to check it out. That's all I can say right now. It's very interesting, though, so thanks for the tip.
Thanks, Rob.
Very, very interesting. Check it out.
Appreciate it. Thank you, Rob.
Okay.
All right.
You know, we have very, very smart callers here. Absolutely. He tweeted that earlier and wanted me to ask you. And and with Twitter, I don't know if you're on Twitter, if you're watching what goes on here during a show, but it's insane. And I try to keep up with all of it. And that blew by. That was probably an hour ago, that question. So now we're winding down, and let's get to a key question. Is Baphomet, first off, is he a leader? I mean, is Satan above him, or is he a leader of the underworld? And is his goal right now, like we had talked about earlier, the gates of Hades have opened, is it now? I mean, we've been talking about the end of the world for 2,000 years. The apocalypse was supposed to happen a long time. It was supposed to happen last week. It was supposed to happen 10 years ago. It's always about to happen, and it always feels like we're in the end of times. It feels like it right now. It feels really crazy what's going on in the world, but you know what? It felt that way on 9/11. It felt that way during the Vietnam War. It certainly felt that way during World War II. It felt that way during World War I, which is probably more horrific than World War II. So it's always like we're at the end of times. We're always there. But is that where we are now? Is that what he is saying? And how is he going to accomplish it?
I mean, that was what he was saying. And that's what Cain says, too. But you're right. I mean, you know, that's what Jesus was saying back when he was alive. You know, the way he was speaking about the end times, it was as though they expected it to happen any minute now. So, I mean, you're right. This has been anticipated for a long time. And from where the spirits are, again, they don't experience time the same way we do. So it's really hard to tell, you know, when he acts like, oh, it's happening any minute now, if he really means it or not. But, you know, again, the thing about the gates of hell opening, I really take it seriously. And I only started thinking about it a couple months ago, really. But it seems to me like we should pay attention to this, you know, and start looking for evidence that there's more demonic possession happening, for instance, than ever before. This is what I'm feeling. I'm not sure, you know, that's just a feeling, but that's... You know, that's the thing that I would point out. All the other stuff about, you know, people try to analyze prophecy and figure out if they were talking about Russia or Germany here in the various prophecies. you know, they try to apply it to the geopolitical situation in modern times. And I don't engage in that much. I mean, I don't know what you, you know, to me, it doesn't, I don't get much out of it. So, but yeah, he wanted me to think that, that it was going to happen any minute now. But then again, you know, Baphomet also told us that we should look forward to going to hell because there's freedom for man in hell.
Excuse me?
So, yes. This is what you asked me when I knew that he was evil.
Right.
I mean, it was in that same conversation where he was talking about the war between God and the devil and how they're playing games with us. As he said, we asked about hell, and he said, yes, there's freedom for man in hell. And we asked, freedom from what? And he said, rule. And then we said, rule of who? And he said, God. So, yeah, there's freedom from the rule of God. And then we said, but aren't you the devil? Don't you rule man in hell? And he said, no, that you have freedom and choice in hell. And therefore you should look forward to it because it's going to be this, you know,
party.
Wonderful world of anarchy party. And
right,
freedom.
Right. Interesting. Now, see, that's a temptation. That's what he's doing right there. But yet he doesn't want to be there. And he's trying to fight to get out of it. Am I wrong here? Is that a little hypocritical? Is that playing, or is that a paradox? You know, he's like playing both sides.
Well, I think that, you know, because we were still, I was researching a lot of Gnostic and Luciferian stuff back then. It still, you know, reached my mind as something plausible, I guess. You know, it scared me a little bit, but it didn't scare me as much as it should. And it took basically a while before I really backed off of this stuff. And the reason why was because I had a falling out with one of my colleagues, and I'm so angry with him. He was stealing a lot of my material and taking credit for it. He was plagiarizing me and trying to ruin my reputation in public. And so I and some of the other friends who were also disgusted with him, we just asked Baphomet, can we put a curse on this guy? Can we kill him? And that's, he said, no, you can't talk to me about that, but you can talk to Satan about it.
Whoa.
And we said, aren't you Satan? Whoa. And he said, no, that we're different. And so we ended up having to talk to specifically the name of Satan to talk about how to put a curse on this person to kill him. And we were told, we were given details about a ritual to perform, which we did. It didn't end up killing the guy, which I'm glad about now. You know, I don't really want to have that on my conscience. But, you know, at the time, that, I guess that you could say that's as far as I took it in terms of doing what the spirits wanted me to do, including evil stuff.
Yeah, so you just temptation, taking control of your mind. You know you don't ever want to hurt anybody. That's, you know, whatever. So somebody plagiarized you. Okay, but it polluted your mind.
Right.
Interesting. Interesting. I'll cover for you. I got your back. Don't worry about it. Let's take one last quick call. Let's just do this. Hi, you're live on Fade to Black with Tracy Twyman. Say hi to Tracy.
Hi, Tracy. My name's Matthew.
Hi, Matthew. How are you tonight?
Fantastic. Hey, I was wondering, what kind of precautions do you take prior to communicating with Baphomet and Cain, if any?
Okay, that's a great question. That's a real great question. Okay. All right. Hey,
I didn't hear it at all.
Oh, did I? You know what? I'm sitting here twisting knobs. Sorry about that. I'll ask the question for you, though, Matthew.
Thank you.
All right. He wants to know if you take any precautions before you start a session.
Not really. No, I don't, actually. You know, maybe I should, but, you know, it's just, I've been doing this so long, I'm comfortable with it. And it doesn't bother me the way I guess it bothers seemingly everyone else. That's why I have a hard time finding partners sometimes. You know, I annoyed my previous husband to the point where he was like, I'm not going to do this anymore. You know, and he was just sick of it. And then some, you know, I keep trying to find people to do it with me. Everyone is so scared. They even if they're interested, they don't want to do it at their house or, you know, there's always some stipulations. And so, you know, that's how I ended up doing it with my current husband, basically, because he was willing and interested enough to do it. And we just start right away. We don't really do much to protect ourselves. My husband is a Muslim, though, so he himself says little prayers and things to to protect himself and I guess us. But so he does it on my behalf, but I'm not really participating. I just watch him do that, and then we start.
Now, have you talked to anybody? Obviously, Baphomet's not going to give you any inside tips, but have you talked to anybody else on the other side on how we can protect ourselves and keep those gates of Hades closed?
Well, somewhat. Okay, actually, I've gotten some answers you wouldn't expect when I did ask questions like that. I mean, when I was talking to Baphomet about the apocalypse years ago, we said, because he was saying that all this destruction was going to happen, the man was going to be jailed in the abyss, there's going to be this giant war. And so we said, you know, is there any way we can protect the people that we love? And he said, love. He just said that right back to us. So that's all he could give us, basically, was that, you know, if we love each other, somehow that will help. I don't know how exactly. I mean, we asked this, okay, I asked, you know how in Revelation it says that there's going to be 144,000 righteous Jews that are
right,
going to
survive.
So
right.
We asked, are we going to be amongst the 144,000 that survive this thing? And he said, yes, sure. Yes, of course.
Interesting.
I don't necessarily believe, but yeah.
Interesting. Wow, what a fantastic conversation. What an unbelievable show. Thank you, Tracy. And
we got
to get you back on, and it's just way too short. It's about 2 hours too short, and we'll get you on soon. So what's your website? It's TracyTwyman.com. The links are up, but what's the website?
Yeah, TracyTwyman.com. So you spell my name, TracyTwyman. And it's TracyTwyman.com. You can get to my website. It's got lots of articles. There's a link to my old website there, which has even more articles on it. And then, of course, there's links to all my books, which I think I have 11 of them now. So, and they're all on Amazon.
Now, did...
including Clock Shavings, the new one.
Yeah, Clock Shavings. Great book, by the way. Are you speaking anywhere soon?
No. I haven't booked anything yet. But that's one of my goals, actually, for 2015. I want to book a bunch of speaking engagements because I have quite a lot to say and a few people that want to hear it. So...
And
I'm working on that.
Are you going to do a live Ouija on the air with Clyde? Is Clyde that crazy?
Plan. No. Yes. Well, or I don't know. We've got a lot of airtime to fill. I'm kidding. But no, he wants to do something on Halloween. He specifically requested me to do a seance. So
on
I
Halloween
will,
night,
actually,
you're saying yes, this Friday?
That's correct.
Oh, I've got to listen in. I will do that. Tell Clyde I'll listen in. We'll give away, while I'm giving away candy, I'll put the radio outside. I've got to listen to that. That's going to be cool. Thank you, Tracy. You have a great night.
Thank you.
Have a great, safe Halloween. Give our best to Clyde, and we'll talk to you soon. Thank you.
All right. Yeah, it's been fun. Thanks a lot.
All the best.
Okay, bye.
Tracy Twyman, and that is a Halloween show for you. How did you guys dig that? Doesn't get any better. I didn't know if we'd pull that off. Last night was pretty amazing. Last night, I mean, how do you top that? Well, you know what you do? You bring on Father Ashcraft, Jack Ashcraft, and Tracy Twyman in the same night. I can't even believe we got through that. Thank you, everybody. Twitter was on fire tonight. I actually had, you know what? How much time do we have? I got 2 minutes. Okay, let me go back. I actually wanted to read this, and it's right here. Hopefully it's not long. Okay, it's not. It's not too bad. Okay, we can get through this together. Oh, by the way, I went computer shopping today, and I saw for the first time, I didn't know they made these like 3-foot-wide monitors that are only like a foot tall. Have you guys seen these? They're like 22.9 aspect ratio. Have you guys seen these? They're like 3 feet wide, foot tall. Guess what I'm getting for Christmas? All right, this is from Ed Millar. Ed says, this is my first Ouija board experience. I remember this event all too well because of how bad I was scared. I was 19, and the story is true. My friend Brent and I went on to a mutual friend's home. After arriving, our friend Rob ushered us into a bedroom, explaining He's got a Ouija board. I was a skeptic. So was Brent. So Rob retrieved the board from a box and we lit candles as well as dim the lights. We first contacted a spirit of a young girl who once lived on a farm since removed from our community in the 1950s. Later, we believe we reached something entirely evil. I was getting scared, and as we tried to say goodbye, the entity would say no. Rob retrieved a crucifix from his dresser top, and it flew across the room, hitting and shattering a window. We were all scared and had no idea what to do until Brent suggested to burn it. Using gas and a couple of other chemicals, it would not catch fire at first. But after it finally caught, the face of the board turned to a familiar shade of red and dripped into the flames like blood. Now, I believe colors were from the chemical reaction to the heat, but at the time, we were all beside ourselves with fear. Thank you, Jimmy, for taking the time to read this. Sincerely, a fate or not, Ed. There you go. And I've said it so many times, and I mean it. No Ouija boards in my house. Tracy is someone that has spent so much time on this, and all of it is in her books, and I've heard her speak many times, and she's definitely contacted two spirits, and I'm sorry, I know who's calling in right now, but I've got to run. This is the end of another night here in downtown sunny Burbank. This is Fade to Black on the Dark Matter Radio Network. I am your host, Jimmy Church. Thank you, Tracy. Thank you, Father Ashcraft. Amazing show tonight. I absolutely had so much fun. Thank you to everybody that called in. Ken Lipson was in the house. Star 6. Matt, Matthew. Stay tuned. Coming up next is After Hours AM. Special thanks to Keith Rowland and Art Bell. Fade to Black's executive producer is Rita Kamarian. Show is produced by Hilton J. Palm and Mark D. Kovar. Announcers are Steve Harder, Gene Vitoa, Mark D. Kovar. Fady is by Dale. Graphics by Method. Music by Doug Aldridge. Intro by Spaceboy. Fade to Black is produced by KJCR for the Dark Matter Radio Network. I'm your oh-so-humble host, Jimmy Church. We'll see you tomorrow night, night 4 of Halloween week. Sha all night. Everybody be safe. See ya.